So again, a quick reminder, we have not seen any of these games beforehand. And, you know, although unfortunately I can't sport the TSM logo today because I just ran out of makeup. That just happens sometimes. We are going to be able to still have the hype and still remember that momentum from yesterday where TSM crushed C9 in the first two games. How is C9 going to come back? How are they going to do it? Are they going to do it? Well, we're about to find out as we hop right into the game. Oh, for anyone who doesn't know, there is a Canadian player represented in the North American pro scene. It's not just North America, USA. It's actually North America because we have a lot of potential in all the different areas. So we're going to hop right on in here. And of course, we have some imports like Bjergsen who are not technically North America homegrown, but have since joined the hodgepodge that is North America. Alright, so remember, TSM was crushed in the past two games, so they're probably going to stick with the more traditional power bands here, and that's what we see coming out, the two most, arguably most powerful champions in this patch, banned right out. That is where they are. The Ivern was definitely a ban because that was a problem in the first game. As well as being able to counterpick that bottom lane. The Ivern ban, the Ashe will block the was played in game 1 where they could have the Karma and the Ivern in game 2 where I believe they had a lot of free reign over ADCs. So this is a power ban from Cloud9. And again, the first pick of Lulu, Cloud9 really respects this Lulu potential. And to be fair, it made a lot of significant plays in that last game. Lulu saved people, though the game was still kind of a blowout. Lulu prevented it from being even worse. And Bjergsen, or excuse me, no, I believe it was Bjergsen who was on Syndra, really made a lot of powerful plays and impacted the game very hard. So since she's not banned out, picking that Syndra here is a nice deny from that. And it's Jensen saying, oh, you think your Syndra's good? You wait till you see my Syndra. I'll show you a good Syndra. Ahri is sort of the like standard power meta pick and has been for several patches. So I expect on both sides, Ahri would be somebody who can like be pulled out and really just utilize the maximum capacity. She fits into almost any composition. She has a lot of flexibility that she can go in her build path. There's a traditional path that the pros like to use, but she is one of those champions that can be a little bit more flexible. She can build an Abyssal Scepter because she gets right in the thick of it sometimes. She can build the raw AP, she can give herself the additional movement speed out of Ludens, you know, and actually make good use out of that because she's a Kite mage. But we see the Karma coming out as an answer. It seems like they didn't want to continue the target bans from last game, neither side did. So they match all the picks and are just going to ban out each other equally and put equal pressure on the AD and top lane positions. Top lane, interestingly, because last game, remember, there was like arguably 6 bans for top lane. This game, it's Rumble, and we do see the AD on hip cannon coming out. And that's some nice respect being shown from TSM since Kennen wasn't something that performed very well for Cloud9 earlier in the series.
It's actually pretty popular top lane.
It is something that has a lot of potential and has been shown to work very well in the pro scene, so that could be argued to have just been an off game. And this is actually what I was about to highlight here. So we see 3 more bans coming out, but none of them was Camille. So I'm not at all surprised to see the Camille first pick to make sure that they secure it for their side. Camille isn't somebody anymore that's like unanswerable in lane. She's certainly can be dealt with, and picking a Fizz into her, Tank Fizz has been really strong lately. He's sort of come back into his prime.
This is going to be a nice choice here for Ray.
And it looks like they are going to lock it in. So that's going to be a very interesting matchup to watch, because Fizz does not shy away from trades at all. And Camille tries to win lane by getting very efficient trades.
Something away here from Turtle, who's also waiting on his pick.
And one of the benefits
the
of
last
the
thing we're
is,
looking
is
to see
so
is
with playful trickster,
our
like
AD positioning
on that pick. And
our
when
AD
you're in
choices
the melee versus
for the
melee matchup like
bot
that
position.
It does limit a lot of the options that the other top laner can have against you, because if you're winning all of those, it's very difficult for the other guy to farm.
And it's going to be Ezreal. So Ezreal ensures a lot of late game potential because he goes tier and he scales up really well with that. Jinx, though, she holds a very special near and dear place in my heart. She's somebody who hasn't been particularly strong.
I mean, five effective bot lane.
She still is the like ultra late game hyper carry champion Jinx is, but yeah, Varus is somebody that's a lot more standard in the current meta. So that surprises me a lot less to see whipped out here.
This is a carry style champion. Haunted though, back on that Camille. He has only lost two games this season on that champion.
Though
so
this team composition doesn't seem that tanky, exactly, especially if Camille goes a bit more damage focused.
And I would say the first
Lee Sin does get fairly tanky early on. Camille does start transitioning into more tanky items.
Someone who can affect lanes extremely.
And Biofrost has a massive shield that he can bring out. So their team is actually deceptively tanky, given how much damage they can put out. Whereas Cloud9 is more of, I mean, Fizz is the same sort of way Tank Fizz is. He's super tanky because he builds tank items, but he's deceptively strong. So Fizz kind of fits that same description. But the rest of the team seems a little bit more pick-oriented. Ezreal wants to go a long-term team fight, and Lulu can help him get there. But until we get to that late stage of the game, or at least mid-game when he's hitting a Trinity Force power spike, depending on if he goes second item Trinity Force, a lot of Ezreals have, even on Ezreal, been going Bork after they get their tier stacking.
Yeah, Haunter has been.
We'll see what path he goes, but he's probably going to have a later power spike, so they're going to rely on Syndra at the beginning of the game.
Start off this game well,
and Syndra has a really strong early game and an insane mid game as like her first ability gets maxed, as her ultimate is unlocked. There's a lot of potential there, and with an assassin jungler like Kha'Zix, that pick potential is huge. So I would expect to see a lot of focus on the for C9 on the mid lane here. Getting some attention top is not bad either, because if you get even a slight lead for Fizz, he can just take care of himself and become that monster. Do note, he's going to ignite teleport just for hyper lane dominance, which is going to position Camille in an unfamiliar spot where she actually is on the back foot in her lane.
How is the top lane going to look? Haunter has been an absolute monster in the first two games, and Array needs to show that he can deal with this guy for them to have much of a chance at all.
And also do note that Fizz is going with the Corrupting Potion start. So not only does that give him a lot of sustain through all these trades, it also makes it so his trades are more effective, because when you pop it, as it's healing you for a certain duration of time after you start using it, it gives you additional, I believe it's a certain amount of magic damage on all of your auto attacks. So Fizz is going to trade even more effectively. So I'm expecting the top lane to start to, at the start, to go in Fizz's favor. Depending on how the ganks go, it can change, but that's what I'm expecting at the very start here.
I am excited.
And you just see how little of Alicia's really need to do those Razor Beaks.
Does he have the
Raptors, rather, whatever they're called.
To invade on Senskara and
some good trades at the start here for TSM.
Or if he's kind of just
nice sidestep by Wild Turtle to dodge the Mystic Shot out there.
certainly felt like his
always love seeing that Lee Sin micro where they weave in an extra auto attack before completing the Q, because the Q does bonus damage based on how much missing health there is on the target.
Wild Turtle and Biofrost just going to
nice
town in
every 2v2.
Yeah, this has been a little bit of the untold story of this series, is the fact that Turtle and Biofrost have been smashing in this lane, especially when they were in the Lucian matchup against the Zyra and the Ashe, still getting large CS.
And note that both ADs did go for the Doran's Blade start, or excuse me, not for the Doran's Blade start, they went for the Longsword start so they could get additional health pots. And that junglers right now are just moving Sneaky's Ezreal has the mastery for additional to get the biscuits upgrade, whereas Varus doesn't. So we'll see how that turns out. Seeing the early trade go in TSM's favor isn't really that indicative, because there's so much sustain on both sides.
Up to the top side pretty early in that wave from Haunter is going to push towards Ray. So that does mean he could be somewhat susceptible to Contracts. Not going to be heading up.
Yeah, it looks like Contracts is going to be pathing back to Wolves. And again, I think the focus is largely right here in the mid lane.
Could have been super risky. If Contracts does blue buff, waits in that brush, that could have been a dead monster.
So this is pushing so heavily in on Cloud9 that it might be worth him to now.
Through some of the early levels, Haunter, bit of an early advantage right now.
They're coming back with a little support to try and get the Scuttle Crab, and now I bet Ari's gonna they just equalize in the mid lane and just focus there.
As soon as Camille goes missing, Contracts has no business there anymore. Yeah. He has to back off because the top lane.
Camille gets
the
good sweep too with the plant there to know that that whole side of the jungle is done. So she doesn't even need to add additional vision. I think she probably already had it in that brush. Knowing that he's nowhere in the jungle and there's no jungle objectives to take there means that she can play a lot safer.
Yeah.
And they do see it just in time.
Contracts now knows what's up. He's going to leave the area.
If he was really paying attention, you can see as the wards time out. So if he was actually watching, he could have waited in that bush and come right back. But this means Svenskeren free to go topside.
Just got the Scuttle Crab. Does miss the knockup. That's enough burst coming out. Really good. If we go back and look at that.
Trading, you also don't.
Oops.
See, as the words
so again, we
out,
see
so he was actually watching. He could have waited in that bush and come right back, but this means Svenskeren.
Camille goes in with the attack on Titan move. She does miss it, but this isn't that bad because it positions her between Fizz and his turret, which is like down here. So this sort of creates a divide, which means Fizz has to path kind of awkwardly this way instead of going straight for his turret, because he doesn't want to take a lot of damage from Camille. And he wants to stay away from Svenskeren as far as he can to deny a Sonic Wave.
This movie already.
Haunter gets the shield, but this is only magic damage, so this won't prevent any turret damage. However, since he has the magic damage shield, and that's what Ray is going to be dealing back to him, this is effectively saying, like, okay, this is my health pool right here, is my health pool that I can use to tank these turret shots. And if I get really low down to like that much HP, I'm actually completely safe still, because I've got a special good against Fizz HP pool that's extended. So this means that Haunter is actually completely safe to tank the turret. If Svenskeren tanked the turret and got low, the remaining HP he had would be just as susceptible to Fizz as it would be to the turret. So I think it's a really good choice to have Haunter tank the aggro here. Even though Lee Sin is theoretically more mobile, he just burned his flash, and Haunter still has flash up. So worst case scenario, Haunter could always flash back out of range, and then they could drop aggro or swap aggro that way. And he lands the Q, so it's not even necessary. And Haunter makes it out.
And even
fine.
Though you bring the Ignite for better trading, you also don't have the flash when you're getting ganked like that. And just the patience there from Svenskeren and Haunter getting into melee range before the hook shot, getting that first kill under raid. That is huge for giving Haunter an edge in that wave.
Good trades there from Jensen. He is out of mana. Remember, he took Cleanse, not Ignite. If he had taken Ignite there, that was 100% a kill.
Yeah, I mean, it's tough for Fizz in those early levels. You don't have the flash as the additional escape. He already used the playful trickster. Really nice sidestep, and he needs
to
sidestep.
Yeah, there's nothing. He has no abilities up. There's nothing he can do at that point.
Ran down, but not able to get away.
And Skaren's comfort on
to the point of the cleanse, you got to remember, Karma has a lockdown. Varus's ultimate is a lockdown. There's a charm.
What's the investment in the early game, though, for Ray?
I mean, Hunter has a slow and Lee Sin has his ult. I'm not sure how well using cleanse against those things would be helpful,
but
these three CCs are very strong, so that warrants taking cleanse in this matchup. Especially because since you're on the back foot, you want to make sure that you're safe and not putting yourself at risk.
Contracts, he really has just been power farming, now going to go back and spend that early burst of gold.
Nice little leash on the way back.
And got a long sword with that
from the support there. Yeah, I mean, instead of going straight back to lane to Ezreal, she helps leash this brush, establish a little vision through the plant, and lingers around this mid lane to both establish a ward here and back up Syndra. So Syndra feels a little bit safer getting her ward even deeper. And now that means the whole bottom side, thanks to the control ward Syndra also dropped, I'm pretty sure it was Syndra.
On both
this
Camille
whole section is completely visible for Cloud9. So Syndra can so cheat towards this side of the lane constantly and be safe. And we see that's exactly what's happening here. Lee Sin's coming in from the top side because they communicated that these wards were dropped. So he's coming in from the top side where they have a control ward and they have the vision. And he's looking for it. But Syndra's cheating so far back towards their jungle and towards this vision zone that he can't make anything happen.
Free kill if you land it.
Contracts is here though.
Looks like damage in there for Ray. Actually already used the ultimate.
And we noticed as soon as that ultimate came out, Lee Sin started pathing up, but Contracts is already here sooner.
Moving in. Haunter gets all the way away with a hook shot.
That's incredible. So they gotta actually finish walking it out, but again, since Syndra is cheating so far down and to the right, it's really hard for her to rotate up through here. And they have vision right here, so they could even see her and path accordingly if necessary. And since Haunter still has flash, he's fine. He's just going
to
eat that fruit and be okay.
Return back to that lane without shopping, thanks to the honey fruit.
He's actually going
to
go back.
Nice attempt for C9, but they come up empty.
Yeah, Sven is hanging around mid lane, maybe trying to kick Jensen into a charm
or go for contract. There's a couple of things here. The common play would be the mid lane dive, but if he sees a level 5 Kha'Zix, he could go.
So hanging out for that bush and not seeing Kha'Zix the whole time, I don't think he saw him path to wolves
for it.
Means that
Ari's nice and mobile though. Great.
Well, let's actually go back and look, because there's a ward here, right? Let's see where Kha'Zix path through. Yes, so they did know he was here.
Yeah,
so they saw him here.
Mid lane, maybe trying to kick Jensen.
So he's
going to
hang out in this bush and try and get the 1v1 while he's level 6 and Kha'Zix is only level 5, right? And possibly take some additional damage from a camp or two. He's looking for if Kha'Zix comes mid a little low after doing that camp, or if he runs straight out after not doing it. That means that, one, this camp is open for him to take. Two, if he's pathing across this way, that means that Lee Sin is free to gank this mid lane, because that probably means Kha'Zix is running towards a camp here that he's going to be preoccupied with after starting, and he won't be able to rotate to respond to this gank as quickly. But being delayed here like he is, and not seeing him path through this way, means, okay, Kha'Zix is still in the area. Since we don't know what HP he is, we have to assume he's full or near full because he has a smite that he can use to heal himself. So I'm going to just back away. If Syndra gets a little bit more forward, we can still make this gank attempt happen. But we'll notice him watching the mid lane here on the minimap. Syndra continues to just play down and back towards her vision and towards the turret, so she's plenty safe. She plays behind, noticeably behind the minion wave even. I mean, look at that. The minion line is going right here, So even if Lee Sin came for something on this side, even though her Kha'Zix is right here, so theoretically this is their strong side of the map, they have such good vision control of this entire area, and they see the entrance over here. The only way Lee Sin could go into their jungle on the bottom side is like through Dragon Pit and then Ward Hop. And that is possible, but it's very unlikely because it takes a long time to set up and you would have to know that all this vision is here so nothing else could happen. So because of that, there's almost no chance he's in this bottom quadrant of the jungle. So Syndra is constantly cheating towards that side of the lane. Even though, again, theoretically, strong side is this quadrant because Kha'Zix is here. And you would see a weaker Syndra player positioned towards her Kha'Zix, which would open up this gank path for Lee Sin, which is why Lee Sin hung out here for so long, knowing that Kha'Zix was there. He would be quicker to the gank. He could use his level 6 to ult her into Ahri, who could follow up with a charm, and they could just unload on her. And even if she had enough balls prepared, there's still the exhaust coming out of Ahri to stop her from getting a return kill. So really good play by Jensen there, counterintuitive to play towards your weak side of the map, but because they know it's a neutral side because nobody else is there, that's like guaranteed safety, whereas we're not sure if we're being matched in our own jungle right now. And we see Lee Sin, although the action's happening right here, we'll get back to that in a sec, I want to take a moment to note Lee Sin wound up pathing through here and just ward hopped over this wall. So now he's like way ganking Fizz from behind. And Fizz, remember, doesn't have flash. So the only real hope for Fizz here is if he can Q through Lee Sin towards the turret and then use Playful Trickster to get away. But we don't know what cooldowns he has up from trading with Camille and Lane there. So that might not even be possible. Looking back at this bot lane
down onto wild
engagement, Wild Turtle's already low, but so sneaky. Supports are pretty much full health. Smoothie's got his health, his biscuit running. The Ignite comes out immediately, because even though Sneaky looks like he's fairly far out of this fight, he is Ezreal. This is Mystic Shot range, right? Especially if he ease in, and then can start getting autos as well. Karma does have the Ignite to match. And she burns it on Smoothie, notably here, right? Since Ezreal was so far back, and the Ignite that came out is pressuring the conflict immediately, Karma has to answer immediately with their Ignite just to equalize. But since Ezreal is so far away from Karma, who was like right here at the time, she can't ignite him. The only Ignite target is Smoothie, who, remember, was like nearly full health. Sneaky was the one who was very low. And now Sneaky can come out with a heal. And now look at this. This is perfect health pools for them. Both of them are about half HP. Sneaky, the one who's more important because he's bringing out the damage, is the one who's a little bit healthier, which allows Lulu to start retreating, throw her last bit of shields onto Sneaky, so he can E in very aggressively and focus down Wild Turtle. Because none of the focus from Cloud9's side has gone onto the support Biofrost. But again, because of the positioning very defensively from Sneaky, after the Ignite comes out and the all-in is like happening, they have to start answering immediately, and the only one they can answer on is the Lulu. So they had to split up the aggro between the two of them. And juggling that aggro, it's just like juggling turret aggro. It's going to make it so they can defend themselves very successfully. So Wild Turtle does make it out alive, thanks to the shield from Biofrost. Ray, I assume doing like Fizz things, either queuing through them or playful trickstering, made it out alive there. Couldn't find the ultimate on him. If Svensgeren can find the ultimate and kick Fizz even further up the lane, that's unfortunate. Oh, that's unfortunate. Okay. If Fizz could get ulted by Lee Sin up top lane, then he's done because Camille could follow up with her ultimate, which is actually down right now. But even just her slow will make it so Fizz can't get away nearly as effectively. And they could probably 2v1 him down. But let's watch where Kha'Zix is coming. He takes the blast cone over. Probably. It was communicated that they saw him walking up lane. So Kha'Zix takes the blast cone over to check this brush, most likely, and come for a gank. Or to find him recalling right here, or recalling right here if he's more sloppy. And what Wild Turtle actually ended up doing was, knowing that this plant was up, he came to take the fruit and heal back up, and then could either rotate back bottom, or since he's already going to be at most this far forward, he could look for a cheeky gank on mid. And between Ahri ulting in and charming Syndra, and the piercing arrow shot from long distance, that might be enough. Even if she cleanses out of the charm, it might be enough just raw damage to knock out Jensen from full hit, full HP. Unfortunately, taking the blast cone over,
not to actually flash.
Contracts finds him.
A kill there, takes a small advantage, but now
you saw Wild Turtle. The reason he started coming back here and had to do that weird stutter step before running, it's because he was going to do the first option of pathing back towards bottom lane, probably coming through here to wrap back to his turret and catch this wave. But then it's like, oh, Kha'Zix is here. Oh, I don't know, run. Red alert. And he's gone. And that's just a clean kill. And that's what Cloud9 needs right now.
And that may help to get Contracts some confidence back. Something going
on. It not only is going to enable Contracts on Kha'Zix, which, if you're Kha'Zix, having kills on you is really good because you can transition those kills to the rest of the map very, very easily. Kha'Zix is such a bursty assassin-style champion that everywhere he goes, he has playmaking potential to get kills. And he can give those kills over to the other lanes, like Fizz, like Syndra. You know, he doesn't have to take the last hit. He can be the opening round of burst and get all the cooldowns out. And then something like a Syndra ultimate that takes a second to channel can then finish him off and then start snowballing that lane. A nice little 9 there, accidentally, for Cloud9. So this is really good to get a kill onto Kha'Zix. And the time dead for Wild Turtle right now. Obviously, he didn't want to back. Otherwise, he would have just backed there instead of going for the heal and coming back to catch the wave. So it's going to mean that he's denied a little bit in all these minions for both experience and gold that are about to hit the turret. You notice Karma already backing off away from the turret because she doesn't want to get 3v1 dive. So she's going to miss all that gold as well and experience. And that is going to help snowball this lane a little bit more. And we already noticed the level discrepancy starting to come in. Sneaky was already a little bit ahead, hitting 6 first out of all 4 of them. That's going to be a little bit more pronounced now because of this death timer and because Biofrost's karma has to back off.
9 jungler. I think that's his first kill of the
so
series.
That's really helpful.
Yeah, that could be so huge for Mention because C9 needs some type of hope in this series.
The playful trickster both to dodge the damage from Camille there and to soften up this minion wave. That does mean it's not going to be available during the snare. So only the Q is available here. Good ult onto Hanser, who is the lower target. He wants to draw the aggro to Hanser first. And putting the fish on him and saying, okay, look, Hanser, you're the one who's going down right now. I'm going to try and kill you. And we're going to start the timer on my passive W so I can do the additional bonus damage with any future auto attacks or abilities. So sure, I may not have Playful Trickster up right now, but you can't get your shield on me because that will draw the aggro from the turret until Lee Sin draws the aggro. So that gives me a little bit of extra free time that I can start this timer. And once we get to 2 seconds, I do additional bonus damage to you. So this is really good as soon as he sees Lee Sin to pull the trigger immediately.
He's gonna look for a vicious Haunter already.
And there you go. So with the kick, the aggro is drawn. The fish coming out also works as a kind of CC. It's a slight like knockup delay. So Haunter can't put out the additional damage as well yet. He queues through Haunter. Both the, again, continue getting damage onto Haunter's Camille. And to create that distance. The burn is on him, but he probably need one more shot to get him. Because he's got the double heals, healing bonuses, and the corrupting potion ticking.
He's gonna burn down.
And his last auto attack procs Grasp of the Undying. So that gives him a little bit of extra sustain. So Haunter had to go forward to continue this fight to finish him off. But now look how low Haunter is. And he just attacked Fizz, so this turret's going to aggro and kill him. So Fizz is actually going to go one for one here. Even though he can vault over the wall and make it look like it was pretty close.
Go on.
Like, Lee Sin had to back off.
And the investment in the early AP does pay off someone. He also gets a couple stacks there. Yep. From the kill, because he had already...
Yeah, and he gets stacks too on this because he died before Camille did. So the stacks don't cancel out. That's actually really funny. That's really helpful because he has two of these. So that's those stacks actually are pretty valuable.
And then he picks up those stacks afterwards.
Two really big moments there. For C9.
In the meantime, though, with all this focus in the top lane, it's one of the reasons it's great that he was able to go one for one there. Couple reasons. One, it means that Haunter isn't in lane alive right now, expanding that gold deficit by taking another wave or like shoving it in. It was already shoved in, so he is going to miss a couple minions here, but there it's not a huge loss in that regard. So the lane is still fairly even, and getting kills on both sides generally tends to equalize the things out because it raises the total amount of gold. So the delta can, relative to that total amount, is less significant. So that's great. But also, since he went even here, it's as if like Lee Sin didn't really do anything. Like, there is an extra assist that was created there, but that's it. That's not really much. Whereas while all that was happening, Contract says, well, hey, your top side, your really deep top side, like, came from behind. So we're just going to go to your blue. We're going to hand that over to Syndra. And I'm going to immediately back, because since we saw you and you didn't have our blue yet, our blue is probably still up, which we see it is. So I'm going to come right back to our blue. And as Kha'Zix, I can actually use that blue pretty effectively because Kha'Zix does get somewhat mana drained. And getting the additional cooldown reduction from blue is really important from Kha'Zix because he's such an ability-focused champion. So getting blues from both sides and securing the first blue onto Syndra means for sure that at worst the mid lane has blues on both sides. And at best, we also get it on a jungler. Who is the assassin jungler that might be snowballing this game?
That game really does unlock Contracts to go make some plays, since he knows where Svenskeren was.
But seeing we're ignoring this action here for now, just because there aren't a whole bunch of balls on the ground yet, so I don't think much is going to come out of this. Notice that Contracts actually cancels that recall, saying, okay, if this blue, he either came to it after that and is soloing it, because we don't see Bjergsen there yet. He's still in lane. Sure, he's positioning to this side. So maybe he wanted to shove this wave and then come get it. But Jensen's keeping him busy right now, as we see, right? So this blue is either secured by them or it's not. And it's not the biggest thing because we already got our blue secured from taking theirs. So what we're going to do instead, seeing that Varus is here, and knowing that Karma isn't yet because she recalled later than he did because he died, we're going to look for the gank from behind. Answer, say, okay, Lee Sin, you think you can ward hop and do a deep gank? I'll show you a deep gank.
circles that he's low, and you can already see the counter jump.
Good harass here. That's actually a lot of damage, but again, since he didn't have enough balls prepped on the ground, that's not enough to finish him off. Even with one more ball on the ground, he probably still would have survived. It's just that, like, if he had prepped, like, one ball on the ground, and in doing so had hit it onto Ari, so that first Q actually chunked her a little bit as well, then that would have been enough damage. But this is just, like, and Jensen knows this. This is not like, hey, I think I'm going to kill you. Jensen knows, like, how much damage Sidra can do, and if I can tell, certainly he can, right? If we can tell, certainly he can. So the reason you ult here isn't for the kill. It's because, hey, I actually landed the stun on you, which means I get an additional chunk or two of damage from throwing the ball on you and maybe summoning a single Q on you. And then all that combined with my ultimate makes you low enough to where if I could stun you again, right, then just throwing the ball back on you and summoning the Q, that will kill you. So after unloading this, sure, I don't get a kill, but I shove you out of lane, and you have to leave right now. And that's exactly what we see happening. Like, Bjergsen's just like, all right, you got me. I'm out of here. I'm glad I'm alive, and I'm leaving.
Yeah, that early null magic mantle from Bjergsen.
No, again, C9 doesn't have any vision control of this part of their jungle, this quadrant. So theoretically right now, Ari could be going over to take the handoff of the blue. But since she's so low, that would be a very aggressive play when theoretically they don't know where Contrax is. So it's more likely that she's going defensively to back, which is why you see the ping exactly on top of her. Because they don't actually know where she is there.
And here's that top lane dive.
But it's just so likely that she would take that path to be safe.
TSM wants to come in. When the fish goes out, they wait that out before fully committing, and then they go for it.
Well, you can see the turrets.
And look, I mean, because all of this damage has already gone on to Camille, the passive on the W is just waiting to be procced.
Wops over to Spencer.
So just one extra auto attack does so much damage. It procs Grasp of the Undying. It procs that W passive.
Goes in, which is
it just
they
does
wanted,
so much. There's nothing
not
she can do
out.
To survive
you almost
that.
Want them to wait another second yeah. there so that Haunter could have comboed while the Dragon's Rage had Ray knocked up.
Yeah, as soon as he would have been out of that knockup from the fish, but they were...
It's a good point by the casters, too, if they had waited before engaging. But that's... Remember when we went over that, how Fizz was, like, staying away from Lee Sin and was starting the W passive on Camille and getting trades at the initial start because she couldn't answer the trade yet, because that would draw the initial aggro to her. If they had waited any longer, Camille would have already taken like two extra auto attacks from Fizz, and she probably would have died equally as soon, if not sooner. So like there was no way.
Worried, I think, about
with the luxury of being able to hit pause like and rewind and not cast live, we can tell that there was no way that even if they had delayed it, that would have worked out for them.
Exactly
this, that one for one trade was about as best as they could do, or a zero for zero if they had backed off.
Jensen missing that Olin, landing a stun and just comboing Bjergsen, saying, I have control of this lane. These are all
good establishing of vision there.
Up in this game.
Another thing to really track in
they do know it just because they have that part of the river warded. And seeing him position like that and then immediately path away almost always means he just dropped a ward there in that brush. So,
they spike so
good knowledge by Camille to know it's there.
It's a race to the Trinity Force. If one player gets the advantage and complete that item before the other, they get complete lane dominance.
And does look like from that longsword, I'm venturing to guess that Ezreal is going to go Triforce second item. Well, it could still build into Bork, so that's not necessarily true. We'll see. We'll see.
We did see an all-in previously, but early lifesteal there for Turtle and some safe items for Sneaky.
Obviously, Varus is going to go for Blade of the Rune King first item.
Good invade here from Contract.
We'll see what happens with Ezreal.
Trying to catch up in the mid lane. I see some pings. Contract's going to check this jungle. Sees nothing there, but does get
good establishment. Have an even deeper vision line, right? So they had the Tri-Brush already warded, and now they've got a ward here and here, which means they effectively control all of this part of the jungle, not including the red buff, but everything around and behind the red buff is theirs. So since they control this swath of the jungle, unless if the minion line is pushed to here or to here, and somebody comes in through lane, right? That means controlling this central block here means effectively they also control this quadrant of the jungle, right? So getting a really forward line like this, it's not just about the deepest ward you can get. Oh my god, so sick. Look at how sick that ward is. No, that's a frowny face. If we just deep wards for the sake of deep wards makes some frowny faces, right? What we want to do is have vision lines. That way we can establish like anything beyond a certain point, we know what's happening. And that extends all the way to the rest of the map, right? So we get in, just by establishing this line here, we get an entire quadrant of the jungle secured for free. And we start to eat away at your quadrant of the jungle. And if we took down either of these turrets, then we could push this line even further in. And we could establish even more control out of that quadrant. And then start to like creep that line down through into the next area. Right now, Lee Sin's trying to answer, right? He's trying to get his own deep vision and establish a line there. Because, okay, we lose some of our jungle, you lose some of your jungle.
Wasted right there. There wasn't much option to dive. Svenskeren and...
And we see there's not that much vision established. There's a fairly deep ward and a ward at the entrance. But this line, like this, protects anyone coming this way. So this is a defensive line to secure the mid lane. This doesn't secure any jungles. That makes it so Bjergsen's Ahri is safe to farm, which is important and good. This control ward is just for the teleport from Haunter. But if this stays here, that will actually go a long ways towards starting to establish a vision line. And even if this ward does go down, having this and this, I'll just mark it on the mini-map, means almost there is a path that if they go right around here and hug the wall, that they can't be seen. But this almost establishes a vision line here, which would effectively secure this part of the jungle as well. So it would answer this vision line that C9 has established. It doesn't quite yet, and it looks like Lee Sin does have both a ward on his, like full ward and a trinket ward available. The trinket ward is probably going to be used for the ward hop in the fight here, and then after the fight would hopefully go in their favor since they're investing a teleport, they can rotate to dragon, and then while they're doing dragon, they can throw a ward, say, like right here, behind the pit on the Silk Road. And that is what will establish that vision line for TSM. So they can have answered and established an equilibrium. Both sides secure one quadrant of their jungle and lose a chunk of their second quadrant, but gain a chunk of the enemy's second quadrant. So that's kind of like the mirrored play you're seeing right now. The part that isn't in equilibrium is this teleport play. And since like they're able to rotate down to start answering this, both Syndra and Kha'Zix are coming on this arrow. Because they saw Ahri start to dip down and probably from this ward had vision of Lee Sin already being in here, trying to establish a mirrored vision control. They're coming in there to try and push them out of the jungle. And note that the two that are coming both have control wards, right? So after they push them out of their jungle, they can establish control wards in this side of the jungle and try and reassert control over this quadrant. And if they do so successfully, what that means is this quadrant is secured, this quadrant is secured, and this chunk of their quadrant is also secured. All for C9. And that vision game starts to look like it's starting to snowball into their favor, especially if they can just shove them out and then wind up a dragon and take dragon. So all of this play is about establishing vision and setting up for this dragon right here. Ray, notably, is able to complete his teleport right at the start. It's actually kind of unfortunate because he teleports in right. That's just good timing by Wild Turtle, actually, to like make sure the Varus ultimate comes out right as the teleport completes. So it's actually going to chain to both Smoothie and Ray. And since they started rotating quicker with the Ahri, Lee Sin, who's already deeper, not only has this be a 4v3, Ahri is going to make this temporarily a 5v3 before the other two can equalize as a 5v5. So this is going to be just completely a disadvantage for C9 the whole time. The only thing equalizing that they have a turret working on their side. So all they have to do is really good juggling of the turret aggro, which we see, it was aggroing onto Haunter and tried to ult to drop the aggro. Unfortunately, he was so low because he was tanking it and they focused him. Good focus by C9 in that situation to take down Camille. So it's 1-for-1. And the turret re-aggroed after Camille dropped it onto Wild Turtle. And since Wild Turtle is so squishy, he has to back off just to drop the aggro. But since he's their main damage output source, aside from Bjergsen, who, notably, has become a little wabbit, so he is no damage output right now until that polymorph ends, Wild Turtle having to back off out of range means that there's no damage coming out right now. Like, Svenskeren's already burned all his cooldowns, so he can't do this damage. And between Lulu and Fizz, those are not very ideal targets to try and turret dive because they have so many tools to deal with that. And we see, by the end of this engagement at this point, we see just how healthy they still are. And that's why you don't really want to get them. So Sneaky, even though he has tools to deal with being dove as well with his Arcane Shift away, and theoretically his Summoner spells, which not both were available, but he was the correct target. Good focus by both sides. Good disengage here by TSM to not greedily trying to wait for more. But because the polymorph slows a little bit, Bjergsen is going to be around. Very good sidestep by Bjergsen to make sure he doesn't get hit by the Syndra stun. If he does, he's 100% dead. But Fizz, queuing through this minion, is actually probably going to hit Bjergsen with his Q, which is kind of a like AoE effect. If you dash through a target, it hits all the targets that you wind up touching and not just the one you targeted to dash through. And just getting him this close to Bjergsen and having to delay past with the juke to make sure he doesn't get hit by the stun from Syndra means that he's going to be in a damage range. So both Biofrost and Svenskeren now have to protect Bjergsen and help escort him out of here, because Contracts is right behind. And this is about to all of a sudden be a 4v3, right? Because again, Wild Turtle is very low. So even though he's right here, he can't really safely participate in this. Because if he gets anywhere in range of Jensen, Jensen's Syndra can just ult him. Or if he gets anywhere near Contracts, Contracts can just assassinate him. So there's nothing that Wild Turtle can do safely right now. So it's only up to Biofrost and Svenskeren to save Ahri here. There's the shield coming out from Biofrost. And getting the ultimate off as well means that he can create distance. And what C9 says is, okay, great. You've used your ultimate defensively off of Bjergsen. Biofrost doesn't have exhaust. So since Bjergsen is in run mode because he just triggered his ultimate, he's probably going to keep running away, which will create enough distance. If he sees the flash from Jensen, he'll probably trigger another bit of his ultimate to run away and create distance. So we're going to focus instead Biofrost. We're going to get this last Q on him, and we're going to ult Biofrost, thanks to the vision from the control ward in this brush. And you can already start to see Syndra's body is positioning, so I'm like 99% sure this is all going onto Biofrost. And that means they'll for sure secure a kill on Biofrost, though even though he's not the biggest target, right now they just want to get a kill, so it's not one for one. And that's exactly what happens. Thankfully, Wild Turtle still did have his heal, so Biofrost was able to flash in range of Wild Turtle so that heal would save him. And we noticed that's about how much heal gives you, so he would have died without that. What's left is only this Kha'Zix, right? Kha'Zix, if he has jump off cooldown, has to jump in and try and make this play. Notably, again, now that Wild Turtle is a little bit healthier after using his heal, he can actually stay on the back line and provide some assistance and some damage output. But Biofrost has to run very defensively. Can't take any more damage. And good sense of mind also by Bjergsen to not get mind game by the Syndra flash and to actually throw out the exhaust in time to make sure that she can't do full damage to the very squishy support. So since those tools are down, though, Contracts, what he might do instead of focusing Karma, who is very far away from him, notably not that far away from the team, but definitely far away from him, is he might instead focus Bjergsen, because everything he has is on cooldown. Most everything, he does still have Flash available, which can save him. But if he focuses Bjergsen, Bjergsen almost instantly has to Flash. And that might be another good grab on the way out of this fight.
Kill him though, and our contract, the next one to file.
Position, as if he's looking for Biofrost. Bjergsen. Too grouped with the team. Not worth risking, especially if he jumps into a charm.
Yeah, so they do trade kills there.
Gonna think better of it. Gonna let them all recall and just take the Ocean Drake right now.
Much closer early game right here as C9 is able to hit back a little bit when TSM goes.
They're actually not gonna take it as we saw at the very end there.
This is a full commitment. Nice.
Just because they're not 100% sure they recalled, but TSM wasn't willing to just let it go. And note, again, since they start on Sneaky, saying like he's the ideal one out of Fizz and Lulu that we want to focus, both to eliminate the damage target and just because he's super squishy, the only tool he has to not die is like his flash and his built-in flash from his arcane shift. So if we can start this off by getting a root down either from Karma or from the ultimate from Varus, he can't use either of those abilities. So he's a sitting duck. And that's exactly what happens. It opens up with the root from Wild Turtle's ultimate. And then Karma gets the leash on him. And there you go. That's a dead Ezreal.
A little bit, but that ult from Turtle was so big.
Yeah, also turret damage, knock up twice
all the way on
there.
The Hunter.
Force Fen Scaren.
Just too much.
Preventing him
could have been more there.
Combo off, and then Haunter took way too much.
If they had stayed for more, though, if that turret had gone onto somebody like Svenskeren, they might have actually overstayed, and the Syndra coming in could have been devastating. So it actually kind of winds up working out in their favor.
The ultimate, man, the turtle ult, and kill all three very quickly. But when they
flash
don't do that,
the heal,
they have to turn
exhaust.
Tail and run. So they didn't overcommit necessarily because they were able to pull away, but they don't get what they wanted with that play.
Although Jensen did get a couple summoners out,
the exhaust and
that heal from his flash forward, he will be vulnerable for some time, you know, especially to Svenskeren if he comes to gank with Bjergsen.
Notice that this ward did expire, so they no longer have this vision line. So Fizz trying to reestablish a vision line like this to make this a safe lane for him again, he's going to start by throwing down the control ward here. And then trying to reward up this river, either in the tri brush or in the river brush. So it both defends blue.
What, twice now, Jensen's.
And it's
too soon to pull the trigger.
And it starts establishing a safe lane for him. The wave being shoved in allows Camille to rotate away to help secure this. So even if all three of them answered, it would be even. It would be a 50-50 on how it would go. And while that's happening, top lane turret would be taking damage and Fizz would be missing experience and gold. So they actually do just have to surrender this. But remember, this happens after Syndra had already gotten the blue from their side. So they have to do this just to equalize that play from earlier. And what do? They don't really equalize. Sure, they get it, but it's a blue on Lee Sin. They couldn't hand it over to Bjergsen. So overall, though it's way later in the game now, or at least it feels way later, that blue trade was completely in C9's favor because they forced Svenskeren to not hand over the blue to Bjergsen. And Lee Sin is not somebody who uses blue very effectively. He can if he gets his ult off, like immediately after getting it. But it doesn't look like he's going to be in a position to do so.
And it's been a theme throughout the series to focus Jensen by taking away those blue buffs. In game one against the Cassio, they were able to do it on the Ivern multiple times, even on the first clear, taking away that blue. And they're trying to keep Jensen down through these little moves.
Yeah, and so much of the way C9 has played...
You know, it's not wrong by the commentators. Still, by taking it, they do keep Jensen down. But, like, it's equalizing because Jensen got lifted up by contracts earlier. So that's not the whole story. In the moment, that's what happened. And since there was a big reset after that fight bottom lane, maybe C9 should have been able to secure that.
For his team post 15 minutes after he
but it wasn't equal because they had already secured a blue buff earlier. Early,
they take away a lot of C9 setup for team fights late game.
Well, so we're still waiting for those first major items to come out here. Jensen and Contracts, though, roaming down to that bottom side of the map. Maybe looking
now we see Contracts again saying, okay, good job, you got the blue buff, but you get something from us over here. That means you're vulnerable to have something taken away from you over here. So, sure, the blue buff isn't up yet, and it's not going to be up for a little bit, but what we're going to do is we're going to start establishing vision in here so that when this is up, when this blue buff comes up, we can take it. And it's no longer like, okay, now you've answered the blue buff we got from you earlier, even if it was on a less ideal target to secure it for. It's now saying, okay, our previous stealing of your blue buff, that's just done. We got that for free because you have now stolen one from us. We're going to equalize. And resetting the equalization point to this secures a single blue buff advantage in the past. And though it's weird to say like it secures something in the past, the way to think of it immediately is now it's been equalized. So this reasserts the pressure by taking it. But you can also think of it as like resetting the way to think about how if they're playing from behind. And if they successfully take this blue buff, it asserts that no, TSM, you are playing from behind this game. And you have to keep answering us and equalizing us.
Or maybe they're looking at the dive.
We have proactive equalizations. And again, this ward both gives them vision of where their lane that they're about to dive is, but it also further establishes this line of vision that allows them with this ward that's already placed to have very good control, not over a lot of this jungle, but keyly over the blue buff. So again, it looks like, whoa, all this focus and action on the bottom lane. It's not about the bottom lane. This is nice. We're going to look for these kills. We're going to try and get it. Oh, too bad there was a control ward. Well, at least we shoved them off lane. Hey, we burned Wild Turtle's ultimate. That's not bad. I actually probably wouldn't have used the cleanse there. He does get to dodge some of the poke.
Yeah, I do not like the delay there from Cloud9 because they had the numbers advantage and they were sitting on the control ward for about a second before they decided to pull the trigger.
This is the cost of going for this play. Bringing so many resources in the form of four players down here means that these two get to wail away on this turret. And note, remember, that first turret still hasn't gone down yet, even though this is like a very significant chunk of the game has passed. Both teams have been like answering each other so balanced that they haven't been able to get a turret on either side yet. And getting this turret is first brick.
Seemed to me
so
like
this is a very big sacrifice to try and control that blue buff. And they have to run as quickly as they can up here to answer. Because as this goes down, Jensen needs to hit a stun on one of them to turn this into a kill. And if they can trade first turret for a kill on one of these two, that not only secures this blue buff, which you'll notice has just spawned now, ideally in CS9's mind, they would have been rotating to this blue buff right now, giving it to Jensen, and then get him back in lane to defend this. But TSM, seeing that play, sent Sven Skaren to this lane to take this turret. So this is actually really good play by TSM to have the game sense to know, okay, this is happening in our jungle right now. We need to get the pressure mid and take something. So it puts Cloud9 on the back foot and having to answer, which is exactly what happens right here. Good stun on Bjergsen. They're focusing Jensen, thinking he's the only one here. Thinking Lulu's the only one here to back him up. Which is some good backup. Lulu does keep people alive pretty well. But it's not the whole story. Because as we see... Uh-oh. I think my computer froze again. Ah, whatever. As long as the stream doesn't freeze for you guys, I don't really care that it freezes for me. I just want to be able to see Twitch chat. And chat looks like it's not frozen. Seeing these two here, okay, we can probably take them because it's a mid and a mid versus a support and a jungler. We can get this, especially if we put Sven Skaren in an ideal position with a ward hop like this to ult them through each other so the damage gets placed onto both of them and the knockup CC hits both of them. Great. And that's exactly what they're going for right now. What they don't know is that Contracts is like right there. And the reason they don't know is because there's a control ward right here. So they don't have, in establishing this line of vision to control this blue buff and subsequently the dragon. But remember, it's Ocean Drake right now, so it's not the most important dragon, which is why we haven't seen anyone take any dragons yet. They've gotten control to where Contracts can sneak in on the backside. And that means this is going to go bad for TSM. Great start. And they actually bring a lot of damage onto Smoothie. Very good focus right now to say, okay, Jensen is probably going to be the one Smoothie is going to try and keep alive because he's a damage output. So he can try and equalize this kill. So after we get the ult onto Jensen and confirm that Lulu's going to ult Syndra, immediately shift the focus onto Smoothie and just zero out Smoothie. Which is exactly what they do. And starts this off with a win for them. And Bjergsen, oh my god, is he going to live right now? Oh my god, that's so unfortunate. Okay, imagine that Bjergsen wasn't a beast and didn't live through this with that health pot running. I think it's even refillable. No, he's chugging a biscuit. Like, oh my god, what a beast. What a beast to know to eat that biscuit immediately. Oh, goodness gracious. Okay, so imagine Bjergsen didn't live through that because he wasn't a beast. All of the cooldowns are basically gone right now. Contracts might have like a couple of cooldowns available, but not super significant ones. But it's a 2v1. So even though the kills would have been equalized as a 1-for-1 at this point, Sven Skaren would be about to die for sure. And probably couldn't answer with a kill onto Jensen, who's got the Lulu ultimate. Bjergsen flashes away! Oh my god! I can't believe Bjergsen just did that. What a beast. So in doing so, that means just to equalize this play for the fight aspect, not even the turret, because the turret's just gone. They have to kill Sven Skaren without letting Jensen die, which is a risky proposition. It could have been possible if they had gotten the dangerous game triggered for both of them from killing Bjergsen, but especially without dangerous game, it was already going to be very close. And we see that here. Without dangerous game, it almost doesn't happen. And Sven does get it too. Incredible. Look at that. The repositioning. Yeah. Okay. We got it. Good for Sven. So it winds up being a 2-for-1 there. And that's an incredible play because it's a 2-for-1 off the back of getting first brick for TSM.
He's gonna knock up there on the fish. Haunter can't leap away in time, but we'll be okay. Haunter holds his ground, doesn't burn the ultimate.
So close again for Jensen, though. The slightest bit of health left on Bjergsen, and that's three times he's barely not gotten a kill, which is really slow.
This is really greedy. Really greedy from Bjergsen to say, okay, well, I'm going to try and push out this wave then to set Jensen even further behind in this lane and deny all of my minions and experience all the gold.
Pulling him down and stopping him.
And it's greedy because Contrax can come in and try and kill him. And it's good recognition of that from Bjergsen to back off immediately, knowing that he's probably coming through the Razor Beam. Okay. Right there. He's not expecting the 1v1 here.
Blowing him down and stopping him from snowballing.
Yeah, and a fair. Oh my god. Okay.
He collapsed by.
So we already see like Fizz has engaged in this trade top, and even started his ignite onto Haunter, and that's low enough HP to where Haunter might die. Haunter needs to use his ultimate here to trap Fizz in a zone. That's within turret range, right? If Haunter can get that ultimate and lock him in, he might be able to use the time that he's invulnerable in casting the ultimate and just walk away afterwards to survive this. But with the W passive from Fizz up, with the ignite ticking, he's got to be really careful and might just completely need to run right now.
They just meandered in as their turret.
Instead, he tries to engage, predicting where Fizz is going to playful trickster to, and just puts himself horribly out of position. That's just a free kill. Because it looks like, okay, wow, I can't believe he one-shot.
Yeah, and a fairly lazy
he one-shot him and did that much damage. I get that. But this is with an ignite, with the courage up to be procced, and with the W passive fully ready to be procced. That's why it does that huge burst of damage. And it looks like, whoa, how did Fizz annihilate him? Well, it's because he invested so much in. And if Haunter, instead of going in like that, had just, let alone used the ability to go away, if he had just walked away and recalled, all of that would have been invested and nothing would have been gained out of it. What would have been gained? Like maybe a push on the turret for a single wave while he's back in buying, and he probably has a decent buy. This didn't need to happen. This is just.
Oh, so that was a mistake.
Yeah.
The passive was fully charged from Haunter, and he just jumped.
Oh,
no, right
and this is a nice byproduct.
The passive was fully charged from Haunter.
This is a nice byproduct of establishing that vision line earlier. And he just... Re-establishing that vision line. Sometimes you find stuff like this. And this is sloppy play coming out from TSM. After those first two games, I was like, you know, I can't believe it. Is TSM, are they going to come out victorious here in a 3-0? Not if you start playing sloppy like this. This is how you let C9 get back in the game. Sure, you still have a gold lead, but now it's effectively nothing.
And then Bjergsen trying to recall early so he doesn't lose too much damage on his turret.
Notice the push from Syndra. While Bjergsen is dead, he can't answer this. So that both allows all this setup from the blue buff we reviewed earlier. Pushing this wave in allows allows Jensen to come in, look for a kill, look for a dive on the bottom lane. Even if they don't get it, they can then fall back together to get this blue buff, and then finally fall back together to get this dragon. And note that while this is happening, Contrax either is going to be here to defend Fizz, or if it's not needed, can start rotating over and we'll meet them at the dragon after they do the dive and secure blue buff. That would be about the right timing to use the smite on dragon and secure
ends
that.
Ends up getting punished, so back-to-back mistakes there by TSM.
Ray starts channeling the recall, so he's fine.
Soul laners.
Sven's Karen isn't like going to kill him on his own. Syndra,
and loose.
Doesn't look like they can make it happen. And contracts. Calls out that he wants to do a deeper clear. So they're not going to go for that rotation just yet. And part of the reason he wants to do a deep clear is because Lee Sin is going to invade, because they just saw Lee Sin coming down here. So he wants to clear out this side of the jungle entirely to deny Lee Sin getting anything by coming in from this invade. If there's no camps to clear, he just loses. And that's exactly what we see happening. So they get
stacks on each of his dark seals, and he's at a
so they get this turret.
C9, their first post 15 minute gold lead of this series. Watching this one more time.
Yeah, look at this. This is what I'm saying. Right here, this is the all in from Ray. As Haunter, you have to recognize if you don't die, this is a win for you. Right? Because Fizz is investing a lot. There's an ignite coming out already. That's not a bleed ignite, or that's not a bleed passive. That's an ignite. And Ray is all in here and is going to take some turret shots to do this. So just leave, man. Just immediately leave. Start walking away. Vault away. Just get out. Haunter. Deny a victory here. Get the shield and get out. And at first it looks like that's what he does.
Right there, but, then you...
but then he comes back in. Haunter, you know better than that. Haunter, you know better than that. Come on, Haunter.
Right here. The biggest
Come
thing
on.
Is that the passive is already charged. That means the W does so much extra.
And in having these control wards here, they know Bjergsen walked through here. So either Bjergsen kept walking and is recalling in a safe spot, which is already a win because he had to walk even further to get himself to a safe spot, or when they come toward this area, this is exactly what happens and they get this
damage
for free.
It would have been fine
and
to
it turns out, Bjergsen, who's window shopping or just being greedy thinking he can recall in time,
just
gets
the
punished.
One thing we mentioned about the potential faults of smashing so hard in games 1 and 2 is you would get overconfident in the third game.
They're coming in trying to reestablish the... I mean, they're counting their blessings that this blue buff hasn't been taken yet. So they're immediately going to very aggressively as 3 come in here, try and establish vision control over this river again, so mistakes like this don't happen again.
Little bit of that there, but you have to credit C9 for making the plays and recovering here to get the gold leading game.
And it looks like they are going to go for this dragon. This is a bit of a risky call, but since they already have Haunter, there we go. Since they already have Haunter, having rotated here to the mid lane to get this shove out, while Ahri can rotate to being at the dragon, they can be here as 4 with the 5th, so in range she doesn't even have to use her teleport to get there. Fizz would have to use his teleport, so the reason to force on this dragon right now isn't just because dragons are nice. Who doesn't want a dragon? I want a dragon, that's cool. But it's because they have a like a non-equilibrium in what would have to be used in a full-on fight here. Fizz would have to use teleport, Camille would not. So that's why this is a good opportunity to start the dragon here for TSM. Bjergsen just tries to find an all-in, forces a flash out of Jensen, good stuff. Actually does land the stun on him, great play, but Bjergsen already having used some ultimate charges is fine. Fish does miss, that's too bad, whatever, no big deal.
Okay,
Fizz doesn't care too much about using his ultimate and not getting that off on somebody.
Bjergsen has a gunblade, which is kind of an adaptation for these Ahri, but we've seen it on the block. Makes sense that Ahri's a kind of champion that can use it as well.
Yeah, we actually saw Huhi run this build.
I hate this meta where there's
really
gunblade on
that game
the
once
laners.
He did get
I hate
going.
That.
The
I hate that so much.
Was quite huge, but we have to track. Haunter did not blow TP for that dragon. Ray did, and flashes down for Jensen. TSM can look to make.
And we see exactly what happened, right? Just to follow up on that point, so you guys know I'm not just talking shit. That's exactly what happened. The teleport was used, so now Haunter has a TP advantage. So what that means is, now Haunter can split push all day, and Fizz can't answer. Fizz has to use his ultimate, which he burned in that fight, so it's on cooldown currently. Which, to disrupt a teleport from Haunter, he has no other abilities that can disrupt a teleport. So for a while, Haunter can split push unanswered. So what they're going to do is bring both Ahri and Lee Sin up here to help secure this turret, open up this lane, and give Camille free reign of this entire top area to pressure and hold Fizz in the top lane where he can't be used to the rest of his team by being pinned here. And then, with Camille being the only thing that's holding him here, they can continue to look for other plays more aggressively on this side of the map. Now, unfortunately, the dragon is down and won't be respawning for a while, so there's not going to be a lot of ways to force plays on this side of the map. But the next mountain, or the next dragon rather, is a mountain drake. So that's pretty good. That's pretty good. You do want that dragon, and that might be enough to bait out fights over the vision control that's being
established.
Right now,
they're trying to crash that huge minion wave into the turn. There's not much C9 can do about it, but it's turning into a little bit of a split push game. We kind of have our first competitive game.
Seeing that they got it for
series.
Free, Ahri just walks back to get all the shove on his mid, get all the last
quickly.
Hits in gold.
And Smoothie with contracts to the left,
all that experience.
Looks like that'll be cleared out, and Spence Scarron
and then pushing it out like she did. It is finally C9 that secures this, because in pushing out the top, even though Ahri went back to mid to push mid as well, C9 did get to have a really strong shove in bottom lane. So in rotating back away, they can pick the blue up on the way. Does get on a less ideal target, but previously the blue steal for TSM went on a less ideal target. So, again, it kind of equalizes. What has to happen right now is TSM saying, okay, you take our blue in that very delayed way. No. You aren't securing that first steal. We are fully reset, and we're going to get an advantage here because we're going to put it on the ideal target, whereas you guys didn't. So now TSM is coming out ahead in that buff trade.
You force down the turret, you get Haunter to his Trinity Force, which is a point for him, and don't leave them in an isolated matchup while he's at a disadvantage. So these little things that TSM does are just so intelligent to shore up weaknesses wherever they do pop up.
Yeah, and when Haunter is on Camille, TSM looks to play more around him. So Bjergsen on Ahri, more mobile than Jensen Syndra, and Jensen does have a tendency to kind of stick around in the mid lane and try and make the game play.
It's interesting watching the bot lane right now.
Necessarily the 1v1.
Seeing that Karma's gonna recall.
The 1v1.
That makes sense that Varus might push this out a little bit more aggressively, and then just retreat afterwards. Yeah, that's what he's doing. He's gonna back off there, let the push happen on its own.
The game is close.
Give himself a recall, go buy some items.
These fights can swing very quickly based on how the teams execute.
Because the whole team is rotating topside right now. Which means that moving around the map is going to be a little more difficult. To make a play happen here. Because they're trying to answer this push in the bot lane with a push of their own in the top lane.
Cloud9 finally poised to try and take over a game.
Yeah, the CNA bot lane has to be very careful. You cannot escape the ultimatum. TSM is lying in wait. We'll see if they decide to pull the trigger. They don't have a lot of vision in the river, which is kind of making them hesitant.
So they're just
going to
back off.
Yeah, TSM.
Good job not face checking that from Biofrost. Might as well use some mana.
This is also where
C9
is
going to
be a little bit more comfortable. We mentioned how their early games in their first 50 minutes throughout the regular season, they actually averaged a minor gold deficit, and they were so good.
And now we've successfully have rotated both top, both of the people to top in the bot lane, and vice versa. So what this does is, it again puts the pressure on the teleports, right? Which isn't ideal for C9 because they're down in the teleport exchange. But since this lane is the one that's shoved and Fizz has control over this, if it looks like a fight's about to break out, Fizz can leave way early and that'll keep the point of conflict here while Camille is resetting that wave and then trying to reestablish push control in her direction. Fizz could have walked all the way back to mid in that time. So by the time her teleport finished channeling, this would be roughly equalized and they would get there at about the same time if a fight was breaking out around Rift Herald, say. I doubt either team is going to go for Rift Herald this game, but just as a point of reference. the mid and late game. And hopefully C9 is banking on the 4-5 does break out.
Team during the regular season, so
that this teleport will be back up. And though it looks like they're all positioning around Rift Herald, again, they don't, neither team is going to really try and go for that. This is just setting up for Baron. They want to start establishing vision control around the Baron pit while it's a Rift Herald.
And Jensen will need to be around mid lane to try and push that down, but
so the all in from both sides comes out. And this is what I'm talking about. This is great play by Hanser. Some people say, oh, duh, that's so unfortunate, he has to run. No, no, no. This is an absolute win from Hanser. Both of them use their ultimates, sure. But Ray uses Ignite. And that's why the advantage was going in Ray's favor. It's because he used a summoner spell. Summoner spells have such long cooldowns. Just lock him in the cage and then vault away. And you win that trade. You win that trade. Again, Fizz is down a summoner. Now Fizz has no summoner spells, no TP, no Ignite, and Hanser has both. Hanser can win the 1v1 because he's up a combat summoner and flash, and Hanser can win the map rotations because he's up a summoner spell and teleport. This is a huge advantage for Hanser right now. Absolutely massive.
Oh, it failed his E over the wall.
And the E's going to make sure he gets out right.
That's not a fail. Yeah, that is exactly, that is securing a summoner spell advantage.
Honestly, Hanser misplayed that a little bit. What you want to do is, once you're already fished, you want to try to use the ultimatum to try to immune that knockup, time that out so the fish is proccing as you go up, and you can come down and try to avoid that little stage of being CC'd.
Obviously, avoiding the damage from the ultimate would have been nicer. That's true. Not that he played it 100% perfectly, but choosing to disengage there, much better than when previously he didn't choose to disengage. He'd choose to turn and try and go back in on him. This is the correct play, and I'm glad to see him do that. So C9 does get the push on this turret and does take it down, so top lane has been equalized. Turrets overall have been equalized, although the turrets are a little bit more critical for C9. That does give some because their mid lane is one of the ones that went down for them. Elsewhere. So this is all kind of vulnerable, and Baron is up now, so having that a little bit more vulnerable to vision being lost is important. They're going to opt to not try and take the bottom lane turret and answer, because the rotation was happening so quickly, and bot lane turret was still very healthy.
Only one of them is
so they're just going to back right away, reset again, so secure that advantage and summoner spells. Okay, by now the teleport is back up for Ray, sure. But again, Hanser has the advantage in flash. So he can outplay him in a 1v1 scenario, or at least safely 1v1 him, even though he has a bit of a kill discrepancy. He's a little bit behind in gold. That extra summoner spell should more than equalize that. Fizz looking to start to rotate mid. They do see an opportunity to fight. The exhaust comes out from Bjergsen, so he survives that. And the team is back here to help. Lee Sin, great flash ult. Good flash by Smoothie to dodge that CC. He would have 100% died there if all that CC had landed. And because of that, Lee Sin's down. Biofrost then has to flash as well, because Ray is an absolute monster who was able to get here first. Notice Hanser decided to take the long way too, because they didn't want to swap who had the teleport advantage. Seeing that Ray was going to walk, they decided to walk Hanser here too. But Hanser's still all the way over here, right? He's out of screen still. So this is not an even fight right now. All this damage Ray is doing is free. It's unanswered. So this is huge. And he actually is able to get the kill there. Can't get any more. Very close thanks to the Ezreal ultimate, but not quite. And only now is Hanser relevant in the fight. And it's already too late. It's 2-0. Very close to being a 2-1. But Zodger works out being 2-0. Right, and this is why C9 is dangerous, right? Can be chained.
then Contracts and Ray come in with the flank because
Excuse me.
Was there before.
Sure, in those first two games, when TSM puts out like puts on a clinic and shows like perfect play with no mistakes, okay, great, you stomp them. But Cloud9, if you give them an inch, they will take a mile. And all they did was give them like an equivalent score. But Cloud9 has been using that score a lot more effectively than TSM this game.
Does get exhausted, but then waits for it to clear an alt. And then you got to worry about spending here and coming.
Yeah, good patience too on Jensen to like use the time he was exhausted to prep a couple more balls onto the ground. And then uses ultimate, so the majority of his ultimate comes out when he's
going
exhausted.
For the angle on Jensen,
that's really
but they
good
try
play.
And change it with the Varus ultimate. Smoothie flashes away before it hits.
Yeah, and it misses the Varus ultimate.
And going back in there is probably the mistake of this fight, right?
Try
okay, great.
Change it with the Varus ultimate.
Taking this in.
Smoothie flashes away before it hits.
Is probably wrong. Seeing Ray was coming out.
He was going for the angle on Jen.
As soon as you see this flash right here, okay, well, this isn't a good ideal position for me. And we have vision, thanks to the minions, of this fizz that's right here. Sure, it's a little bit off screen, but they know because this these minions are providing that vision. Sven needs to get out of here this way, not re-engage. And if he does, like, finish the Q, he needs to do that only as a jump to, like, getting out of here. But he tries to go for the kill. He tries to finish the damage. And look at that. Again, it's even more stark when he actually does take it because he waited a little bit. Let's see if I can get the actual frame here. Right here. You can see where he just queued from, right? Trying to get you guys the actual frame. So look at this, right here, the ultimate from Varus just missed, the charm from Ahri just missed. You have no supporting CC, you have a fizz coming to annihilate your backline. And this Karma doesn't have any way to stop him. Her cooldowns are up. You need to get the hell out of here. Going in like this is just a bad choice. It's Lily Syndrome kicking in. Sure, she's a support. Sure, she's not full health. You probably can't kill her. She's a fucking Lulu, man. Come on.
Ultimate smoothie flashes away before it hits.
Yeah, and it misses the Varus ultimate and the charm from Ahri, which allows Ray to go deep in this fight, take down the first kill, and so much of the gold is going over to him on their.
And now they get
exactly
the dragon on the back foot. Very good play by TSM to say, okay, you know what? Sure, you got the kills, and sure you're trying to like reset control of the map, establish top lane pushing. Like, get some vision dropped around Baron. But all this focus around here, around the top side of the map? Well, sure, we just lost a fight. But after doing all this, you guys want to back and, like, spend your gold and, like, refill your sight stones and stuff. So we're just going to immediately rush this dragon as quickly as we can and try and take it for free. Definitely a greedy play. But the logic behind it actually makes sense in why it's safe. Because they're not playing greedy. This is a calculated risk. And this is what I like to see from TSM. Calculated risk. The dragon did reset, but it's not going to matter. They didn't go for it. So that's just winds up being a free mountain dragon for TSM. Very good. So they definitely needed that dragon.
That away as long as they can keep the aggression up and keep the wards deep in TSM territory.
And C9 really is at a
and importantly, also it denies it from C9, who are now going to be the ones that are pressuring turrets. So denying the additional damage to their turrets, it's more of a defensive dragon for them currently. But when they come into contests like Baron, that's going to be very important.
The last game was significantly further ahead, but that double spell plan point was really where Jensen could start blowing people up.
Flames are kind of just resetting right now. Camille gets the push out on the bottom side. That forces Fizz to go in to reset the control of the wave. Sins are going to take blue. Great.
Moving into the next 10-20 minutes.
Trying to keep this vision control.
C9 organization is putting into Ray. They have a former
pressuring the red. Oh my god, he took it.
Are right there to steal oh. The red buff. But they have this former
wow.
champion.
Wow. Wow. All right, that's a sneaky W. Sneaky is good at that.
Impact on the bench, and they pull right back into on an elimination game in the finals. He's only played one third of their.
So good pressure. They're applying that pressure, trying to establish, hey, like we have control over this part of the jungle, which infers control over Baron. And they're actually playing a little bit further into that than they can. But now that C9 or TSM has to answer that and reestablish control here, it means a lot of their vision, like denial and establishing potential, has been invested defensively. So in that, because you see how many, there's three control wards here, there's several wards here, I'm sure they use the sweeper in that area. Just doing that and putting that amount of pressure means that it establishes that this is the forward point for C9 by contrast. And that's really good. Karma goes forward, just throw in a ward, but because of the control ward there, that's just a sitting ward that doesn't do anything.
Longer game now.
And Bray is at such a strong point that you kind of have to make
Bjergsen trying to shove this wave so they can get pressure mid, which will allow them to push into the river a little bit here and establish vision control.
Yep.
They're actually going to group first to make sure that they all stick together. They don't face check with anyone. Again, not in a critical bush, but it's establishing the vision control. Right? This is establishing a line of vision. And they're trying to say, okay, you may have this control, but we're going to stop you from entering from this angle. You guys have to come from a sub-ideal angle. And once they, if they can defend that, they can reestablish a little control over here, and all of a sudden the control is now theirs. And it gives them opportunities like that where they can look for a charm and maybe get a pick. If they had gotten a pick there, then all of a sudden this is that could have been a free Baron, even. And that could be game. And with that Mountain Drake, they do have the ability to take it down very quickly.
Force out the TV
using that push, C9 clears out a little bit of vision there. Good job.
Yeah, and you can see the momentum.
Fizz, remember, now that he has the combat summoner advantage on Hanser, because Ignite is a bit more of a combat summoner than Flash, especially in that matchup, he's going to press the split push again. Sure, both of them have TP, but he thinks he can 1v1 since he's a little bit more ahead of Hanser. He can probably 1v1. And he's going to try and use that to his advantage.
Momentum in this game is definitely in the favor of C9, which is miraculous after how badly they lost games 1 and 2. The mental fortitude to come back and have a lead in this game. But even with that, it's still just a 2,500 gold lead. Any fight goes a little bit
wrong,
and TSM would be able to get the gold lead and most likely the Baron.
It really depends on how all these rotations play. Biofrost, using the sweep again, using it defensively to try and reestablish control here, but that seeds so much of this to TSM or to C9 from TSM.
And now it feels like C9 can enact that.
Good
game
job not face checking there.
Really do in the last year. This
he saw one of them poke out.
Battle for vision. They have not seen Jensen.
Threw another control ward to try and get the vision.
Get a double slow. Shields out
saw
there.
Having seen that be thrown down, they do wind up clearing
really
it.
Emphasizing the vision around this Baron area, especially with Syndra, it's incredibly strong with that Syndra.
And this is again, the defensive vision from C9, or from TSM. It's necessary against C9, because they're trying to bushwhack. If they can bushwhack even one person, they can get that Baron.
Ozic's combo, if you can control the area, force
it's
someone
so
to come close. You hit one stun, they are going to go down.
And okay, so you guys have a little bit better Baron control. Fine. We'll recontest it later. First, we need to control mid wave, so they all group around mid. Make sure that Hanser has plenty of time to do his thing bottom. Fizz is recalling right now. And the reason to recall in a position like that is just in case your team does want to create a fight right now, you will be back in base to trigger home guards, which you actually can't see on the boots anymore, but just everybody triggers home guards, and to get a buy off and drop whatever gold you have to get an extra item completed right as the engagement starts, where Hanser has to TP straight there with just whatever he happens to have, you know? So it looks like Fizz is actually going to cancel the recall because Hanser just shoved it out. So Fizz is going to answer that by reshoving back into TSM and then doing the same thing. Every time he's going to start channeling the recall until he sees the that the recall isn't necessary, then he's going to push out the wave. Just looking for the pick here. Hanser, seeing that he's there, pushing the wave back out and continuing to rotate this way means that they're about to all in for Baron. Either by trying to do their best to sweep out control and like absolutely establish a vision line that has complete control over vision of the Baron pit, or just take Baron. That's what this rotation is saying right now. And right now, Camille's on awards, so C9 knows it. So Fizz has two options. Fizz can either keep pushing and let his team try and do a Baron dance and just delay TSM from starting it and let the split push Fizz pop off and just do his thing, taking as many objectives as possible to counter the Baron. Or Fizz can immediately start recalling, and as soon as the fight breaks out, can TP to one of these deeper wards here and get a really nice flank into the back line.
I think these control wards out of the river is actually pretty critical.
Fizz finishes the wave and immediately recalls. So they're looking for a fight right now. TSM tries to clear out the vision, does so successfully, backs off. They don't want to do the Baron, they just wanted to force the vision fight. They note that Fizz isn't there anymore. Fizz starts walking, notably bottom side, in case if this fight doesn't break out right now, that way he could walk back to the lane and start split pushing. But the whole time he's knowing, okay, there's no way I'm going to walk to this in time if a fight does break out, especially since Camille is just here. I need to teleport. So right now as this fight breaks out, Wild Turtle flash ults, doesn't actually land it. If they decide, okay, that's a good enough engage for us as Cloud9 to say, hey, no flash on the ADC and no ultimate, that brings a lot of CC on our team, let's fight. Fizz can teleport to any of these minions, to this control ward, to this ward, to a deep ward behind them to cut off a retreat path.
Okay, now flash
but Fizz is ready to TP in as soon as they decide to fight.
Scary now.
So seeing him not TP means that they say, hey, we'll just take that for free. That's an ultimate and flash down on Varus. So now they definitely can't force Baron. We will beat them if they force Baron. So just keep heading bot and get the split push on.
Nothing was expended. Not even an E from Sneaky to sidestep it.
Yeah, now the fear of a teleport flank is even larger because...
Good job taking the scuttle. This can't be swept out. So this is a nice consolation prize for TSM trying to make a fight there and having it go wrong. They will know if C9 tries to do the Baron.
Because if Ray just gets close to Turtle, there's nothing
but
he can
Ray
really do
on
to
Fizz,
escape. So the vision battle TSM
making his way up bottom.
To play even more conservatively to try to get that back.
He's going to go through the river, but he's still heading bottom.
Here, not gonna spot anyone from C9 moving.
Seeing Camille there, and seeing how far up his team is pushing behind the Baron pit, means that he can actually start walking this way instead of answering Camille. And that'll free up Syndra to rotate up to back up her team, which makes that a solid 4v4. And note, Ahri is rotating first, so they want to free up the Syndra as quickly as possible. And it means if the fight breaks out then, Camille has to use her teleport, whereas Fizz is already there. It does force the initiative on C9 to actually make the fight happen, but Fizz will be there sooner. And without having used any teleports, so even if it just becomes a fight for kills and no Baron is taken after it, they do answer. So what happens? Well, Camille says, all right, I'm just going to immediately start recalling them. That way I can get back to base to answer with that TP.
one of those people to think.
Fizz shows bottom, says okay, if you're gonna recall, I'm gonna shove the wave.
Even just the scuttle.
And this is just a nice little push pull seesaw that's happening.
Because that gives
cute
them the confidence
little secure there from
Spin. Has not entered the pit for any normal.
And they're sweeping out the pit. This is like the most tense 5 minutes of the game right now, is where they're struggling back and forth over this vision and this initiative. Right now, all of C9 is recalling, and the critical members who needed to recall for TSM already have. So this is an opportunity to fight for this Baron if those recalls complete. And it looks like they do. Looks like Ponser is getting the better of the trade right now.
Well, it's a really long play. Bjerg's gonna have to run down.
So, getting this better trade right here says, hey, even though we'll be equalized in TPs, mine will be more effective than yours just because of our health pool difference. And though they don't know for sure that they all recalled, if they come in and all in this Baron right now, that might be a free Baron. Very risky play. If they had complete vision of the map, it would be the right play, but they don't. So, what might be the right play instead is a Drake. All this time and energy has been invested on Baron's side. But in the meantime, there's a Mountain Drake which will help take Baron. If you get it. So they're sending Ahri down here to both establish some vision around Drake and pick up her blue buff. Lee Sin is in mid, so he's near the dragon. And Hauntzer, who just won this trade, has better control over bot side. So all of the sudden, there's control for TSM here, here, and here. And that means they control the dragon area, because every resource in the game has been used in the past few minutes fighting over this dragon area, or this baron area. Ray, seeing this, tries to get a little vision and tribe rush, but it's too late. Lee Sin's like deep invading to try and counter a red buff. Oh, 2 HP. Oh, that hurts. Especially because Ezreal really likes having Red to kite even more effectively. And the Sin has Blast Cone.
Why is Finn scared in the air? The rest of his team is elsewhere, so everyone tries to kill him.
Look at that. I can't believe this guy got away with that. You can't let him do that to you. You cannot let him do that to you. This is horrible for C9. An utter disaster that he was able to deny all of that.
High risk red steal for sure, and now they're trying.
Very risky, but oh man. Red buff
doesn't do much for now.
Now they're in a very sub-ideal position, and they just have to try and rush this dragon down. So that gives really good initiative here to TSM to start this dragon how they want. They are going to drop aggro on blue, and look at that. Even though they aren't there as five, because Varus is up here on Wild Turtle, even though Cloud9 is here as five, they had such a bad start on this dragon, and there's stuff like this control ward and this vision ward just sitting here. This is not a properly prepped dragon. This is not a safe dragon. And this is not a safe fight even. So, sure, they've got contracts on the dragon, and they theoretically have this zone of control right now. But that can change at any moment, and all TSM is doing right now is looking for a key engage. Sven is close enough to the dragon to where he can go in and try and, like, 50-50 smite steal with contracts. And there's nothing either team can really do about that. But they're just looking for a pick. If they can get a fight onto Sneaky, if Wild Turtle can come in from the back line and get a good ult off, easy money. Ray, seeing that the dragon was low, went in on Sven's Karen, which forced this play in retreat right here. Which right as the Baron is low, right as the dragon is low, will secure it for C9. All because of that Ray going in with his Q. Great Fizz play there. Of course, it's a safeguard. The Lee Sin Sonic Wave is already down, which makes it so C9 can disengage for free. Very risky to try and take that dragon, but now the Mountain Drakes are equalized. And they have the upper hand on rotating over to mid. Good poke on the, you know, on the little icing on the top there. Ray goes in for a little trade. Again, not really trying to trade effectively there. Just trying to buy his team time to work down this inner turret and mid.
Monster's actually pushing bottom right now, though, so if TSM is to fight, they would need a flank teleport.
Monster trying to answer with the bot lane outer turret. Not nearly as significant, especially since the dragon just went down. Sure, Infernal Drake is next, so they want that. But that's not the critical thing right now. What's critical is this Baron. And TSM trying to answer by saying, okay, well played, but we're going to reassert pressure over mid. And we're going to get the mid pushing this way now. And we're going to try and re-answer with the mid inner for your guys' side. All the while, Hanser is going to be getting a free turret. So if they could make that happen, that's a huge advantage for them. However, it's not a guarantee. And Cloud9 rotating to try and stop it. Sure, they lost their minions in the proxy, but they equalized before they backed off. But that does give Hanser this time. He already took the outer turret. Now he's going to get that inner turret. So, okay, you guys got our mid inner, but we got an outer and an inner in bot lane. Not the most relevant, but it does open up a whole bunch of area down here for Camille to split push with. There's wards here, 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 and here, which means this entire zone, depending on where the minions are, is controlled for TSM, right? This whole zone is Camille territory. And since this is going to be a split pushing game, where dancing around this Baron pit is decided by teleports, having huge control of the polar opposite side of the map for where the objective is very critical. And that means TSM is in a much better position right now to get this Baron.
They kind of waffled in the middle, didn't start there.
And to assert control over him. C9, good grab of the Scuttle Crab.
Team gold going the way of TSM, which will help Monster out in this matchup so much.
Yeah, we've seen Ray just consistently.
TSM trying to do a rotation of getting people recalled to itemize effectively here. Prepare for this last, what could be last engagement.
Monster is now up 400 gold.
Couple of important items were picked up there. Some additional resistances for Bjergsen. Some additional CDR for Wild Turtle. You need to land
that
fish
so you can understand where they're going for that, because that's their play to make the game go wide open. But once Monster has killed that first turret,
Ward is disabled. They aren't going to kill it to give away their position, but they do have it disabled, so they have complete control over Baron
pit. Bottom, reset the play, but they were too slow doing that.
They've got Fizz and Camille, both sides splitting.
Allowing them to get the vision.
TSM is saying, okay, we're going to reassert the push mid, thinking that we have enough control bottom, even with Fizz answer, to where we can control this wave thanks to that huge vision control. C9 says, okay, we see you guys mid trying to reassert this push here, right? So we're just going to all in this Baron. We're not going to kill this ward because it's already disabled. So it doesn't let you know we're on here. And the fact that you see it not being cleared infers that we're somewhere over in this zone, ready to counter push mid, when actually we can sneak this Baron.
It really does feel like
so this is the sneak coming out.
In the pit. TSM should be aware of this.
Fizz dips out of vision and starts the teleport channel, so he'll be there first. They'll
TV
be all five.
Still
not seeing them. They realize, oh no, they're on Baron, aren't they? Hanser starts TPing himself. I can't quite tell on the map where he's TPing to. But they got it. They were able to rush it down again. Thanks to that Mountain Dragon they secured from that risky play, they were able to burst it down quickly enough before TSM could react. Hanser, also not having complete vision of where they were, had to teleport very sub-ideally. So he's still way out of position for this fight. So as this fight is starting to happen, it's 4v5 for a little bit. Contract's a little too aggressive there for my taste. But Lee Sin, definitely too aggressive there for my taste. And Lee Sin goes down. And now it's a 4v5. Sure, Fizz is locked in the Camille ultimate. But it's Fizz. He might actually go down. No, he even survives. It looks like TSM is going to make it out without any more losses. But that, more so than the 1-0 there, 2-0 rather. Though that is an important thing. The death timers are, it's late enough into the game where the death timers matter. But what's critical there is they got Baron for free. And now that means they crack the base. They get the most critical inhibitor and mid inhib. And now they can all recall with the enhanced recall. And get items, and then regroup elsewhere, use the minions pushing up mid to create pressure there while they all group, say, bottom lane, or even have Fizz split, though now that they don't have teleport, they'll probably group as five. Beautiful job not hesitating to flash and just walking away, you know? It's what we talked about with what Camille needs to do. Just walk the fuck away, man. Okay, Lee Sin takes it in to try and finish him off. Well, if you come to me, I'll cue you, and you'll be isolated because he came to me. Perfect. Perfect play by Contracts. Good dodge with the wild turtle with him as well. And good job ulting just for the stealth to try and get harassing. All of that play comes together. So much was invested into Ray, and no one quite ticked down
for C9. Now TSM looking to set up a play.
TSM, knowing that they're going to start splitting, gambles that they're going to split bot side because that's where Fizz already was and he was prepping that wave. So they say, okay, I imagine you're going to try and get this push on bot lane. So we're all going to try and group here. And when you come into here, into our vision, we're all going to try and bushwhack you, especially if you come and rotate through this area that we just swept. I think that's probably Karma's sweeper. We're going to bushwhack you and kill you. That'll take a Baron off. And that'll put one of you on a death timer. So we have a little bit of equalized time. To where even if you're pushing with Baron, we can still hold you off. Because we have 5v4.
Is available from Barris.
It's a play that has to happen at this point. Otherwise, they're not going to be able to make this work.
Contracts is off on the side. This may work. No.
Very good sweeper. Look at that presence of mind by Syndra there on Jensen. Say, okay, you know what? We want to get this push going on. Let's just establish control along the way and escort the push. Let the Baron do the work. Let Fizz's split mid with the Baron-empowered super minion do the work. Take as safe, as slow a route as we can. Ward up along the way. Just make sure we don't face check. Because again, that is the only way TSM can make this work out right now. So why not deny them that? Fizz gets to rotate quickly. Notice that the teleport is still down, but he's not far away. I'm less concerned about that because Fizz has cleanup potential. What I am concerned about is how far away Contracts is. I don't think this was the best fight to pick. Jensen really wants to zero out Wild Turtle. But because of that, it opens up an engagement opportunity on their back line. And Sneaky gets picked here. And he has far too greedy, and exactly what I was just praising Jensen for getting that very critical scrying ward down to see their team and let them all know they could play defensively. He then stepped too far up with the minions and went to try and get a kill. I think that's far too aggressive when you can just walk in safely, wait for this next minion wave here, and walk that wave back in. And the whole time, could have had Fizz splitting mid, which would force some of TSM to come back mid to answer this. Instead, TSM can actually get some kills now because they equalize the numbers by getting a couple kills. They can afford to send somebody back to mid lane to stop the super minion push and still maintain control over this bot side. So just trying to press the advantage too hard for C9. Maybe a little bit of the jitters there from being behind in the overall series score that they felt they had to make a play. And Jensen was a little trigger happy. But this is what I'm saying about, like, why I'm not concerned about Ray being a little late to the party. as Fizz. Fizz has a lot of cleanup potential. Even with how wounded they are, Smoothie's a non-factor, Sneaky's dead, Jensen doesn't have Flash now, so he has to play really careful. Contract is too low to do anything, so he's a non-factor. But Fizz can still possibly get some kills here. All five of them are like, oh god, it's Fizz, get away from Syndra so we can all just survive Fizz. And he does get the big fish too, which hits Haunter, which is what allows Jensen to try and get his ultimate off on him. Doesn't quite get the kill because the invulnerability from Camille's ultimate dodges some of it. But they do get Fizz down.
And when the AD dies at the start of the fight, man. This game is not that out of hand that Ray can just wander in at the end of it. That was a play where Ray was hoping to collapse on TSM, but TSM struck first. So the decisiveness pays off there.
It yeah. seemed I knew they were there.
I don't know. It seemed like that could have worked. That could have worked if... I'm trying to think here. Oops, yanking out my headphones. I'm trying to think here. Come on. I think that if they had been a little less all-inny with trying to get that through Jensen, trying to get the pick onto Wild Turtle, Ray would have been there at an optimal time. It was just a few, if even Contracts was still healthier, Lulu was still healthier, I think that dive in, even though he was diving in five people, could have worked with Fizz if he had any follow-up support. It's just because...
And Siki just walks up.
Not that necessarily he was late. Obviously, if he was there sooner, it would have worked out.
With the middle inhibitor already down,
but if they had, like, delayed and been less greedy with this engage... Look at this. Look at how far Jensen is stepping forward. There's no reason for this. The only reason Sneaky is allowed to step this far forward after you know they're all here because you just scribed them, right? And they threw down a control ward here, so they're actually going to fight over this tri-brush. The only reason Sneaky's allowed to do this is because Lulu can save him if he fucks up, and he has a built-in flash through his arcane shift. So Sneaky's always, like, right here right now. Jensen should be playing equally as far back as Sneaky is after his arcane shift. This is insane. He sees the Wild Turtle, he doesn't see the rest of the team, and he goes for the kill on Wild Turtle. Sure, if you get it, that's great, but this is insanity. These super minions are not giving him the cover he thinks they are. And again, remember, almost more important than that, more important than Fizz being late, is how far Contracts is away right now. Contracts is down here in the slash. He's not a part of this fight. Like, watch how long he's not a part of this fight.
And also, look where Jensen
still not
is.
A part of it. Sneaky's dead. Still not a part of it. Jensen's flashed. Still not a part of it. Here he is. After Jensen flashed. Sneaky died. Smoothie's half his health is gone. It's too late. Contracts was here way too late. People are going to call out the Fizz on being too late. But I think Contracts being here is what made the
not
difference.
Exactly
he was way too late being in River.
For a fight when
and
spent
a beautiful job following
away.
That in. Get enough damage on the Smoothie to where they can finish him off. He's really low.
They
actually don't wind up finishing off the finish off Ray. I forgot that was the second kill. Whoops. Uh-oh.
This guy is
right,
very tanky. He's not glass cannon.
And it's a tank Fizz.
I think the Kha'Zix was actually what cost that fight there. Obviously, if Fizz was a little bit quicker, that would have been supremely helpful. But I think that's what you expect when you're sending a split pusher without teleport. I think what isn't to be expected is Contracts being so late to that fight.
Infernal coming up.
Yeah, they still do have the gold advantage. They have an inhibitor down, so they have map pressure, and their split pusher is still very strong.
Feeling this, they're looking for bushwhacks. So, they feel the pressure.
Nine,
they know that they
want to
like
when you are at
keep that pressure on. So they keep investing in these control wards and just sitting, waiting for bushwhacks. Even using Bjergsen as bait here. Bjergsen trying to proxy the wave a little bit to draw attention towards that brush.
Including the early
C9 says, okay, no. We saw you try and bushwhack
yeah,
in the bottom tri-brush.
C9.
We're just going to rotate up and get the push off. They still have Baron on a couple of their members. I think it hasn't timed out yet. So sure, TSM is going to say, okay, well, if you're really going to avoid our bushwhacks in here, here, and here, what that does is give us a pseudo line of control that allows us to take this Infernal Drake for free. And that is, they're getting quite a nice collection of dragons that are going to matter. These are going to matter. An Infernal this late is very important, too, because it gives that percentages when there's a lot of raw stats built. So the percentages actually amount to quite a bit. So this is good play from C9.
And it's a good play from TSM,
but it's an equally good answer from C9 saying, no, you guys can have that dragon or whatever. We're just going to get the push on. We're going to use the Baron while we still have it. Note that it's like only got about a quarter left. And we're going to try and get another objective out of this. We're going to try and take down this turret. It's not Elder Drake yet, so we don't care that much. Next Drake is Elder. So yeah, we are going to have to fight for Elder.
Someone is missing down towards that dragon, so we'll see.
And that's really funny that it says Drake when it's not Elder and Dragon when it's Elder. Interesting. I'm going to start making that distinction. This.
They're probably going to have to wait for a rate of
in my commentaries
first,
from now on.
Are setting up for
And I like this here, Cloud9, not overextending into a siege. Already got someone clipped by Wild Code.
Sven,
there's a lot
I'm not sure why he was hanging there looking for a pick. It seems like C9 would be moving as one. Though, as I say that, looks like Jensen wasn't. So maybe that was actually a really good look for Jensen to go look for a pick there. Definitely good to recall on a control ward to make sure he doesn't get caught out. Now that dragon was safely secured. Top lane pushing out right now. It's going to crash about here. Here, hold on. I'm going to crash about here, I would imagine. And then start pushing in again. But for now, it's pushing out, and it's going to be far enough to where they won't have to worry about a huge amount of pressure on this turret in the near future. They'll be able to rotate and answer that with plenty of time. The thing they can't stop is the super minion push still coming up mid, and the rotation down here into bot lane to try and take this inner turret. So all of them are rotating and answer off of the mid lane where they were finishing out that last pushing wave towards this turret to try and defend it. They have to be really careful because they don't have vision here, so they have to take the long way around, which they do, but they have a lot of wave clear. The Hurricane especially helps too. Haunter goes in, and he's tanking up the Lickburn engage. They don't find a successful one, so they disengage really beautifully here.
C9 defend well,
really
continue the siege on this tier 2.
Yeah, three pairs of Ninja Tabi onto TSM.
Gives time for Ahri to go back mid, try and wave clear a little bit. She has to peel off prematurely because they're slipping. You can see just from their positioning, they're slipping on control of defending this turret. So they actually call her back prematurely, say, okay, we're going to take a little bit of damage. It's going to screw up our minion wave that spawns for the next spawn. Because they're all going to aggro mid. But we need to defend this turret. So we're calling that the priority. Ahri come back here. She does. Haunter looks for an engage. In seeing that he gets the knockup CC. And that the rest of Cloud9 is all right here. So in the actual game is like right here. They're all positioned to fight like this. And Ray is just trying to like deny this point of entry for defense. So Haunter getting a little bit of CC and knowing that he's got a huge DPS behind him is just going to ult Ray, zone him in this region and say, okay, Ahri, do your stuff. Let's try and zero out Fizz. And if we can do that, we'll get a kill on Fizz. We'll make it a 4v5 and we can maybe win this fight.
Almost acting as tanks right now.
Fizz actually denies the ultimate from Haunter.
Come in from the carries as well. That will be a big turning point because there's almost
with the playful trickster. That's so hard to time right, especially if she's ulting immediately following up after she just stunned you with her vault. But man, look at that. Look at that. This huge, very impactful ultimate out of a top laner. One of the reasons you pick Camille down for free. What do they get out of that? Just a little bit of poke onto Ray, who's a tank and doesn't care. Oh my god.
Sick from Ray. Dodges the ultimate of Haunter with
now they have to give up this turret. And you see that right now. Immediately after that, they're like, alright, well, that's too bad. That was our chance. Time to leave. We're going to go to mid, defend the actual core of the base, push the minions back out of mid, defend whichever one of these two lanes that they decide to push, most likely bottom. And we're going to try and keep this base alive.
Yep. Out of Haunter, so that does fizzle it. That is completely gone. I don't know if that's enough for C9 to want to pull the trigger, but they are pushing aggressively to at least try to get this tier 2.
They look here to try and defend it because it's so healthy you don't want to give it up. Look at this. Again, Haunter trying to just pull the minions away to stop the other waves from misaggroing to them.
Mobile, but these are the small windows where C9
but it's going to create a lot of pressure mid.
And Ray feels like almost just frustrated.
They still can't really find a good initiation. Lee Sin says, okay, if we're going to do this, we got to go all in. Wild Turtle gets the ultimate onto Jensen. Sure, Jensen has cleanse, and he uses it, but that gives Sven time to come in here, safeguard over, and get the ultimate started onto Jensen, and flash. Notice he has flash. This insect is coming right now. Jensen's going to get knocked into the team. 100%. Should be. But the Lulu ultimate comes out and knocks him up as he goes for the insect. So then the knockup knocks him safe. And they can't get him. Redemption comes out too soon. All this is Lulu. All of this is Lulu. They wind up making it a 1-for-1 in top laners, and that's it. If Lulu hadn't have done that like killer ultimate right there to knock up Sven Skaren, Jensen would have died there for sure.
Finally, so it's a 1-for-1 trade, but TSM put everything and couldn't get the kill.
Jensen is trying to bite off more than he can chew. He wants these kills so bad.
Yeah.
Very lucky he did not go down, or that would have been a complete collapse for C9.
Flash charm. It's Jensen. Man, that's like 3 or 4 times this game. Jensen's trying to be the playmaker and close it out. But he's playing way too far forward, man. And he's getting, to be fair, now they're having to flash to punish him. But they are, and it's late and it matters.
Jensen continues.
So they do
manage
to defend this turret. It also helps. I tried to click like this was a replay. It also helps that this inhibitor respawned. So that means there's no super minions right now. Sure, the wave is still drastically pushing in, and it's even pushing in for top lane as well. But the fact that there are no supers means it's pushing less aggressively. And there's an objective here that will hold up until the next wave can properly come and push back.
Still
so that gives them time to do this. It alleviates some pressure.
Gets killed one time. If that wasn't
and
enough,
after they clear this out, this wave will naturally push. And they can keep
the
rotating up
farm,
with Bjergsen, who's going to get that top
Jensen,
farm.
He gets a stun, so he wants a kill, but the whole...
I mean, again, look at that. He gets the stun, he wants the kill. That's exactly
that
right.
Farm,
but you
Jensen.
Can't do that, man. Look at how... This is perfectly fine right here. To be this far forward to look for this stun.
And
but what's not fine is... Okay, you already started walking back. Because you saw they're too far back. I can't do that. But then you said... Okay, no, fuck it. I want this goddamn kill. That's wrong. Don't do that. I do that. Don't do that, Jensen. You're better than me.
That's
don't do that. And look at the end of this, how far forward he walks. Look at the positioning. Ignore that Varus is like getting a really clutch ultimate right now onto him. Look at how far forward he is. Again, Sneaky has his... He has flash? It looks like he has flash. But even if he doesn't, he has Arcane Shift. So Sneaky is right here effectively right now. This is where they all are. Maybe a tank in Ray could be that far forward. But they've instead decided to place Ray over here to try and zone off this entry path. So you can't... There is no tank here. There is no way to be that far forward. You don't have a tanky jungler. You have an assassin jungler. He is way far forward past this line. And he doesn't have flash. So if something like this happens, he can't react properly.
Wants a kill, but
all he has is cleanse.
Is there. Gets kicked
almost
really
gets the insect.
And ultimates coming out from
only switch. Reason Jensen lives here is because Lulu saved his ass. Both just by making him more tanky with the ultimate and shield, but also the knock-up on Sven. Even if all that shielding and healing had come out from Smoothie, if Sven had been able to get the Lee Sin kick back into the team, Jensen was dead.
This
fight would be even
look
worse
at
for him.
Just barely missed that.
Jensen Monster did barely stay alive. Flashes in, but just beautiful play, turning him into a bunny, getting good damage onto him, making sure they play back. They do wind up trading Ray for it. But turning that into a one for one is super hard. I think C9 should have devastatingly lost that exchange. The fact that they got a one for one is just huge kudos to their ability.
Burden of execution on him in this matchup because when he gets picked, the team loses.
Baron's up. TSM looks like they want to go straight to it. Already starting it up here. Sneaky is in mid
lane. TSM just immediately going to rush it.
Him and the team. Ray is in base.
I'm not sure if they know that it's warded.
Haven't warded the pit though, so Cena knows.
Hanser going on to Sneaky here.
What's happening? Sneaky
doesn't stop the ultimate, but it does mean he's locked in with Hanser, which is not good. And he's going to die for sure now. And that might be a... That might have been a Baron for TSM if they'd stayed on it. They opt instead to say, hey, we just got Sneaky. Let's try and get Ray too, or maybe Smoothie if we can, now that Smoothie just flashed to try and get in range to save Sneaky. Unfortunately, too late. Sometimes that happens. But if they can get Ray, or now the vulnerable Smoothie, that's two for free. They can just shove mid out and take an inhibitor. Shove any lane they want, probably mid because it's the most far forward. But this is not really that much trying to kill Ray. It's mostly trying to rotate mid. It's great that they're able to get the hookshot onto Ray though.
That's his GA, he's gonna die again. Smoothie trying to flash over his
hips out of the way. Not enough. Come play, pass it.
Might actually survive in Salute, but the slow I think is too much. Yeah, he went back in, he was done.
Gets the kill. Almost certainly Baron for TSM, and that...
So they can shove up mid, but seeing that Lulu and Jensen's Syndra were already there. I'm not exactly sure where Contrax is. He might be mid as well. Oh no, Contrax is up here. Seeing that Contrax was going to reestablish control over the Baron pit if they shove mid, and it's really hard to shove against two mages that have wave clear. Lulu not nearly as pronounced with the build that's a support build, but nonetheless still has some amount of wave clear. They say, okay, we're just going to press the advantage we have immediately on the objective that will allow us to take all of this. So here they come. Here they come for the Baron.
If they get this Baron, it's a stone's throw away from closing out the series.
So smart by
they
Hanser
finally
to
see
wait
the ward
in that rush
clear
right
out.
There and goes for just the right target.
Hanser just zoning right now. Not expecting a kill. There's even a GA on to Kha'Zix, so they can't kill him even if they want to. He's just trying to zone him all the way away from the Baron. Great, he makes him jump in ult away. Jensen trying to be a hero. Look, man, Jensen, I love you, dude. You're trying so hard to be the hero of this game. I love that play, man. It just puts him so far out of position. Like, again, look at how far he's out of position right here. In this case, I actually think it's fine. Because, like, if this works, he actually does single-handedly, like, turn the entire game. So it's absolutely worth the risk, especially since Lulu is, like, right here. And he's retreating through Lulu, who can, like, whimsy him and shield him to help him get out okay. But, like, it's stuff like this earlier, where he just went for plays that, like, are low percentage plays. And he just needs to not do that.
Jensen's maybe caught out.
That Baron was down to 100.
Just throwing that down for yourself. So also nice to get a little damage in.
The speed of the Lulu,
there's
the
teleport, and that's what's going to screw
Okay.
Lulu does get out, but that's the price of trying to go for that steal.
Jensen,
that's probably worth
it.
That's the one thing. All the times Jensen didn't die, and I was hypercritical of him. But one time he does that, I'm like, actually, that was fair. That was probably worth it, and he probably had no way to get out of it. So I'm actually completely okay with that death from Jensen. This is just amazing play by Haunter. Beautiful catch on the Sneaky. And just nothing Sneaky can do about it.
Just
wonderful. Great.
Hello,
Baron buff timer, so we can see. It's notably going to overlap with the Elder Dragon spawn, so they can use Camille to split push. If they can't end the game before them, they can use one person to keep the Baron pressure up while the rest of them take that over. So they're going to definitely get this, because again, Jensen is still down during all this, and they're going to rotate top. Look at that huge, huge wave of minions that is built up top. They're going to escort that in, they're going to at least get this, then they can recall, and then they can all rush down, pick up blue buff, use the wave that's already pushing here, and secure that Elder Dragon. Here comes out the recalls, wrong hands, so they're much quicker. Yeah, not to even take the blue buff, just because it doesn't matter. They just want to get this Elder Dragon. If they can get the Elder Dragon on top of the Baron buff, they win. Contract's desperately trying to establish vision control. Unfortunately, he didn't have any open slots. He does only have his jungle item for vision. Going down what he can. They get the scuttle. That's very good. Seeing that Contract's is there, they just decide to all in him. If they can kill Contract's and deny a smite, that's either a free push to win or a free dragon with them push to win. Blast Cone actually brings them fairly out of position. Suddenly, what was a 1v3 is now a 4v3. And note, Kha'Zix has a GA. So if he was isolated like that, sure, you can get him. But not now. Don't try and finish him off. You need to back away for sure. And now Sven is in the exact opposite position. This was a beautiful... Oh my god, look at this rotation from Cloud9! Holy god, this might be what wins them the game right here. Okay. Let me go back and explain why I'm so excited about this. Look on the minimap, right? Contract is pushing forward, trying to get his wards out, trying to establish any sense of where they are. Okay? Three of his teammates are right here, rushing towards him. The other one's right here, trying to reset the wave and then rush towards him. Reassert control over the wave and then rush towards him. Uh-oh. They're coming for me. Well, don't worry. We're already rushing towards you. And Fizz says, uh-oh, we'll all rush towards you. Fizz immediately leaves the wave. Look at that. He's already rotating. Fizz already rotating up. And Fizz can hop over walls, notably, so he can get here very quickly. And then the other three are, like, right here. Not these three, but, like, they're on this spot in the map. Contract looks very vulnerable. He has his GA up. Just if all he does is walk and he dies here and then goes into his GA, all five of his team will be here on top of him to support him. Sure, he loses GA. That's an important cooldown. But he's not going to die for nothing. This blast cone was absolutely insane. He screwed Sven and Haunter out of their position. Haunter has a GA, so he's okay. But notably, Sven doesn't. Sven doesn't have a GA. Contract does. So they take down the smite from C9. Oh, wait, you didn't. You actually have to take down our smite again. Oh, but we can take down your smite one time, and he's gone for good. And that's GG, because we get dragon. Maybe not GG, but, like, we get dragon, and now we can fight you. We can fight you off if you try and use Baron buff still. And look at that. Here they all are. Fizz is, like, right here, just below where we have vision of right now. Contract was fine. He looks very low. He's fine. He did his job. He forced an engage that has now become a 3v4. Even if Contracts doesn't participate, because Fizz is here. Right? There he is. And Contracts, having a GA, will participate in this fight. So it's a 3v5. Where are the other two from TSM? They're still all the way up here. They came, but it took them a lot longer because they weren't all grouped together. This was the front, like, invading force that was just trying to establish control over here. And they went for a pick onto Sneaky. And again, because of this blast cone, these two got way out of position and still haven't been able to correct their position. And Biofrost had to continue to go forward from his safer spot here just to try and help defend them to get them out of there. And he hasn't been able to. They haven't been able to.
Stun out onto Sven.
It goes Ray.
Sven, maybe not the one they want to focus as he has the GA, but he did just get shirked, so they do decide to go in on him. Or excuse me. But everything I just said right there was wrong. Sven is the one they want to focus because he doesn't have a GA on him, and he's been sharked. So they do all go, all of them as one, go this way. And that focus is because he's the jungler without a GA. Let's kill him. If we kill him, we get control of the dragon, and we take down one of their Baron buffs.
So they're going
all in. Contracts taking a lot of damage. Needs to be careful, so he starts healing up.
Still chasing a devil.
They can't quite finish him off. Monster comes in.
Finally returns the fight.
Jensen, here's what he's been looking for the whole time. Jensen got some poke. Jensen might be able to ult Sven and kill him. Oh, but he ults Hanser. Oh no, Sven. Or Jensen. Jensen. You're killing me. You're tearing my heart out, Jensen. I know you're better than this, man. Oh, man. Chat, I mean, you know he's better than this. You know he is. Look at this. He throws it in. Kicks the knockback out. This is their ward, so they have vision. These guys, if you draw a radius from Syndra, this is the curve. They are equally far. This one has more health. This one has a GA. This one has less health and no GA and carries their smite. Kill Sven. If they kill Sven, this goes completely differently. Look at that. I mean, he didn't get the safeguard up. It looks like, oh, well, he safeguarded away. No, he didn't safeguard until the ultimate's channeled. Right there. Show the exact frame. Just to make absolutely clear, right? Not here. It's when she first throws the balls down. Right? Like here. Even a little bit after this. Like, this is when the ult has channeled. This Hanser is equally as far away as this Svenskeren. This Hanser is equally in vision as this Svenskeren. Ult the Svenskeren, man. You gotta take out the Lee Sin jungler. Sure, they pop the GA, but this gives TSM an opportunity to reposition a Hanser, or to reposition Svenskeren way safely in the back, and take forward positions around this Hanser, who has a lot of resistances and a lot of health that's about to be regened out of the GA, so they might not even get a kill here.
But Contracts is so incredibly low.
And Bjergsen leads off right as the GA is about to come back up. He ults in and charms, not to even get the kill, assuming they're going to react to it. He does that because look at the zoning it provides. They all have to retreat as this GA comes up.
Bjergsen over the wall.
So Hanser's fine.
They're going to protect their jungler. They need to around this objective.
Both teams have mountain drakes, but the ocean could actually be pretty critical for TSM here as they can.
So given how low they are, they're both going to back away.
Because they choose to reset.
Both teams backing off. That was so incredibly close to both junglers going down. If either one does, it all but ensures that Elder Dragon for their team. Wild Turtle, though, already on the team. They had the Baron recalls. They're faster to the play.
Exactly. They can start Contracts.
Oh, my God. Because of the Baron recalls, Contracts doesn't feel safe going back, and because Wild Turtle started it, Contracts doesn't feel safe going back and putting his team without a smite. So he just... Contracts doesn't get to do anything in this fight but jump over and try and last hit the Baron with smite. That's all he gets to do this fight. So even when the rest of the team gets her, it's a 4v5. Contracts can't do anything but try and last hit with smite. Goes in now. Does he get it? Oh, it even reset a little bit there too, and he's still trying to get it.
Flashes out the safety race, gets over the wall with Playful Trickster. Elder Dragon now for TSM.
Contracts with the very early smite there, Svenskeren. Cool under pressure, nails the smite on the Elder Dragon. That's a triple buff Elder Dragon here.
And those are the types of plays for TSM.
Three different buffs all accentuated, and they still have
it,
Baron. Well, Baron's timing out right now, actually.
And if you don't, it's just the one Mountain Drake that will be being enhanced by the Elemental Drakes there.
This
so
is
TSM.
Still very close. Look at the gold, guys. Like, this is still anyone's game. It's just while this dragon is active,
with the triple elemental Drake,
they have to be really careful to choose their fights
start in the bottom lane here.
Only when it, it gives them a huge advantage.
Can,
looks like that Baron Man was actually slightly wrong.
We do have to remember the win that C9 got was the GA off of Haunter. It will make him more hesitant to dive deep, and Svenskeren does not have a GA either. Contracts does have his active.
Fairly low amount of magic resist from Haunter as well. So
Jensen. Let's actually look at this. Hold on.
Low amount of magic.
Okay. So I've been hypercritical of Jensen this game. You guys know I have. But look at this. Jensen is very far back. If this is the line established by the minions and his teammates, Haunter's engaging past this. He's diving into a squishy. Now, Haunter's Camille, so he can do that, and it can work. But Jensen's not horribly out of position here. Jensen has both his summoners available. Jensen should be okay here. This is unfortunate and all, that now he's locked, and now he can't continue to reposition. He goes as far back as he can. His teammates come in at an angle to try and start body blocking and zoning out Bjergsen and saying, no, 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 this is the line. You are still diving past the line into danger. Good redemption coming up, trying to keep him healthy. Fortunately, Bjergsen does a lot of AoE damage, so he's going in to try and get as much damage as possible. They do get the kill on Jensen. They answer it with a kill on the Haunter, whose GA wasn't available. Remember from earlier, it was popped. And now, the interesting thing is, after that happens, because Bjergsen went in so deep, look at how deep Bjergsen's in now. The second Haunter dies, whoa, Bjergsen, you are in a lot of danger. Danger, danger. It's three of them. You're two people isolated. Neither of you have GAs. Sure, Sven is tanky. You are not, Bjergsen. And the remaining members from remaining member from C9 is just out of camera shot down here. Whereas yours are way over there on the mini-map. Your two members are way far out. So this is a 3v2 that's about to become a 2v4 before it finally equalizes 4v4. This is how you play around the Elder Dragon, right? Sure, you've got it. Sure, all your stats are insane right now. But if we have numbers advantage, like 3v4 or 3v2 into 4v2, we're going to win those engagements. Contracts is the one that goes the most forward because his GA is still available. Sneaky, coming in on the flank, is able to get a lot of damage onto Bjergsen, who's just, he's done now. I'm sorry, Bjergsen, I hate to tell you. But now look at that. They finally do make it there. And Contracts is low. Sneaky is low, sure. Again, Contracts is about to come out of GA. But he needs support to successfully do that. Sneaky can't give him support. Smoothie is low enough to once he goes into GA, they can turn on Smoothie and kill him. So by the time Contracts comes out of GA, he can't do anything about it. And Sneaky's going to be zoned away right now. Yeah, look at that. He has to flash. The only saving grace here is Ray. Ray, this whole positioning is on his shoulders. Smoothie, running away. Sneaky, flashing away. Contracts, in GA, I can't actually see his body. He's somewhere around here in GA. All this is Ray to push these three members away. Which Ray, being Fizz, Tank Fizz, can do it.
TA's gonna go down right.
Sneaky, trying to stay relevant, trying to stay within Mystic Shot range to help defend Sven. Or to help defend Contract when he comes out. Ray doing as much damage as he can. That's where Contract respawns. That's actually even, like, more risky. Contract throws out the heal. What is effectively a heal for him to start backing away. Ray starts backing away immediately. Playful Tricksters to deny vulnerability time. Contract almost goes down, but Smoothie! Smoothie ult, what a god! This Smoothie, oh, this Lulu this game! Oh my god, you guys, Lulu has made so many clutch plays this game. I'm telling you, I think so far in previous games too, even though they lost them very significantly, Smoothie was doing some insane stuff and was making some really clutch plays. I think Smoothie is the MVP so far for C9. Oh man.
Go down here and Sven tries to leave.
Sven takes, whoa, way deep. Okay, Contract has no GA. So he's gonna get the kill, I would think. Yeah. So maybe that's worth it. But like, do you really want to trade one for one when you guys have the Elder and you guys have this massive push coming in? Into pressure the Nexus turrets. Maybe you don't trade one for one there. Sure, they can walk back and regen, but like, look, they have to retreat now.
Badly to fight with that Elder Drake, but it makes them push too far, too fast.
The ultimatum there from Haunter, trading out his life.
Oh man,
Jensen, but Smoothie was able to keep alive for long enough for it to not be a disaster.
Look at how close this game still is, man. 14-14. The gold advantage is like only a couple K difference, which at this point in the game is nothing.
But look who is so much faster to the plate. That's four members of C9 when about two and a half.
Sneaky Arcane shifts forward even to make sure he's part of the play. They're so long.
This kick threw everyone onto Sneaky. Watch Sneaky splash. If that Q hits, the game probably ends right there, as he would
beautiful
certainly have gone down. They
Sneaky
would not been able to continue the fight. Key miss from Sven Skerr.
And even then, Sneaky,
he even flashes to go for it. So he decided. He decided not just to go for it, but to invest flash. So that means his insect potential is gone for the rest of
the
game.
The split jungler here in his first finals. Incredible amounts of pressure.
And so much of this game as well has been decided off of tempo. Who can control the waves? When C9 actually lost the tempo, was
all right,
when
so the important thing, again, remember,
on the bottom side. Right
as you
now,
see all the vision coming out
C9
right now,
does have the minion waves pushing.
Cloud9
have created a little bit of
is this Baron that's up in another minute.
It's still pretty close. All of those plays TSM made were based around one pressure advantage they gained.
There's a vulnerable shred the super minions are pushing out right now in favor of TSM.
To get some of that control back.
Well, now that we've
but
gone past 45
the inhibitors
minutes,
have now respawned. It's equalized. It's frozen there.
But they can still sweep and win themselves.
It's even again. Yeah, this is effectively an even game right now. That goal differential is nothing for 45 minutes into the game.
If they could win
all this is the next fight. And the next fight, all that is either about positioning these two side lanes. It's almost certainly not going to break out mid because there will be too many people there to provide too much disengage potential. Or it's going to be fighting over vision control around Baron. But look at this. TSM has not asserted any control over Baron.
And look,
any control right now.
Baron is up in
this is a horrible
seconds.
Mistake, and they're recalling right now. They're going to have to run blind so into Baron. This is horrible.
Everyone's stocked up. We're going to have one big fight around the Baron, and if it goes horribly wrong for one team, the game's probably going to
look at how much vision they have. That's just
tools.
Insane to me. They're even going to get scuttled.
Difficult for C9. Ray
absolutely
the
absurd.
Sharp, but
this wave
is
pushing out right now.
And Jensen is the main initiator, but also one of the main priorities that TSM want to jump on. So TSM
all this vision,
have the initiation.
It's going to reset
Varys,
like there.
The
all
the
that vision is
the
theirs.
They have far more tools right here.
They definitely do, and I wouldn't be surprised if C9
they're shoving out mid as hard
a
as they can
slow,
to try and buy time to go to Baron and establish vision.
On Jensen before the final fight as that sixth item, it's so important to be able to try to combo someone down.
And sure, they sweep out some vision on their way in here, but they have such good vision control that they're not even gonna get it all. And they see the Lee Sin Q coming out before they clear out all their vision. So even if they did clear out all the vision, they would still know that they're all in the
TSM
Baron right now.
Looking to force before he can do that.
Yep, looks like Baron is going to be started by
so now they have plenty of notice. Sure, it goes down fast because they have a Fire Drake and a Mountain Drake.
Ray off to the side.
But look at this. Oh my god, look at that ultimate out of Sneaky. Oh my god. My goodness! Oh, it's so sick. Ray's coming in on a flank to hit all the backline squishies. The team is now dividing itself because the squishies are backing away because the collapse is happening. And the people who are in melee range on the Baron are slower to rotate out. And Sneaky's, that's the best Ezreal ultimate I've seen in a long time. It hit all three squishies, and it chunked them each for like a quarter of their health, 20% of their health. Insane. Riz gets to all in immediately. And look at this. Look at this engage. It's so good. Look at the positioning. This line is great for all the damage dealers. Only the tank is deep. These guys, sure, they're getting into the like back line of C9, but they were just on Baron, taking all the Baron debuff, taking Baron aggro damage.
Kind of
cooldowns they used on Baron. Jensen actually gets kicked away by Lee Sin. Notably, remember, because he doesn't have that flash, he couldn't insec. If he had been able to insec him instead, this play could have gone completely different.
In fact, yeah, but Jensen might be safe from that Ray, still tying them up.
Ray hanging on.
Lulu ulting to get the full man knockup at the
GA. Does go into GA. So he's still okay for now. First kill to come out is on Camille. Fizz, when he comes out of GA, has the cooldowns up again. So he's able to be fine. Svenskeren can't quite get into a good enough position. And now he's dead. That's jungler down. That's Baron. That's game. Right there. That's it. That's it. Cloud 9, they did it.
TSM, Baron call. They kind of
TSM has to do a miracle play right now. Oh man, then it's not going to happen. Not with that. Really good attempt there by Ari. But what happens? C9 does the right thing. If they had stayed on the Baron and made a split call there, this could have worked out. But because as a team, they all went. I mean, look at this. Jensen, like, flashes just to reposition here. Like, this is the kind of team coordination play you have to do. And since they all move as one here, sure, okay, you killed our jungler, so we can't Baron now. But now we killed more of you, so we can just push to end here. We can kill Wild Turtle. Sneaky doesn't even go down.
We'll see if they can do it.
This with inhibitor is open.
To catch the minion wave.
Top has a minion wave right here. At worst, they can take this inhibitor and then rotate to mid inhibitor and kill that and get two inhibitors for basically free. Or, best case scenario, they say, hey, look at this timer. Like 10 seconds for the next person. We can just end. We go all in. Biofrost will survive. The Biofrost can't do much else.
The Haunter up in 3 seconds, but the Nexus will be exposed.
That's it.
Now ready to go. Nexus is there. Haunter.
Haunter's alive.
Save the game.
This doesn't have GA. Doesn't
have it.
C9 right back in it.
Cloud 9. There it is, man. Good for them. They're doing it. That was really close. And it certainly wasn't a stomp like the first two TSM games. So, like, I would say TSM is still very heavily favored right now to win this series and still possibly just even close it out next game. But, man, maybe the makeup running out was symbolic. Maybe it was symbolic of TSM running out of steam. Maybe. Well, there's only one way to find out. Stay tuned. We're going to go on a brief break, and we're going to come back with Game 4 of the North American Finals. Oh, I'm so excited. I hope you guys are excited as I am, because this is a good game. These are good games. I can't believe C9 won it. They're coming back. They'll come back, kids. Oh, man, we're on a break.